It's showtime! Only last week, I murdered a rock, injured a stone, hospitalized a brick. I'm so mean, I make medicine sick.
They call me the problem, but you can call me the can man, because anybody can get it. Africans, Americans, Dominicans, Mexicans, anybody can get it.
I was going to rip his heart out. I'm the best ever. I'm the most brutal and vicious and most ruthless champion there's ever been. There's no one to stop me. Lynch is a conqueror. No, I'm Alexander. He's no Alexander. I'm the best ever. There's never been anybody vicious. I'm Sonny Liston. I'm Jack Dempsey. There's no one like me. I'm from Nairclaw. There's no one that can match me. My style is impetuous. My defense is impregnable. And I'm just ferocious. I want your heart. I want to eat his children. Praise be to Allah. And bitter.
All right, boxing fans, we're definitely back. We're glad that you're able to tune in to us here at The Boxing Voice, a place where all boxing fans can have a location where they could chop it up, give their opinions, call in and make their opinions live, talk about upcoming fights. You didn't like a decision? Call us. You love the knockout? Call us. As always, I am your host, Ness GTO, and this is the official TheBoxingVoice.com radio and podcast. And we got a great show today lined up. Our guest is going to be Juan Manuel Marquez. Excuse me, I'm pretty sure there's a lot of you guys excited about that one. But I met Juan Manuel Lopez. I wish we had Marquez, but he's riding on a high right now. But, yeah, we're going to have Juan Manuel Lopez on. He's going to be taking on Mikey Garcia. I don't know. I want to hear definitely your guys' thoughts. So, you know, the number is 201-688-7127, or you can Skype us at The Boxing Voice, T-H-A, Boxing Voice, all one word. Before I move on, I just want to say I'm not necessarily happy about Juan Manuel landing a shot at Mikey Garcia. It just doesn't make any sense to me. He lost twice to Orlando Salido, and then all of a sudden he's back in title contention. I just don't get it, but it is what it is. We're still waiting for our co-host, my friend, your friend, Victor Salazar. I don't know what's going on. He's having some internet issues. I mean, you guys get on me, man. Anything I say, you guys take shots at me. You guys need to get at Vic, man, for still having DSL. Like, who even uses that, man? That's like DSL is just as bad as dial-up, if you didn't know. That's like 3 megs up. That's ridiculous. But I definitely want to also recap the Vernon Parris versus Manuel Parris fight. I want to talk about the Derry Jean versus, I think his name is Pendavaris. And we just got a new request here from Franklin. So, Franklin, you're all set. Hopefully you call in and we get to hear your thoughts on the sport. But I want to get everyone's thoughts on Derry Jean. I mean, he just put himself into a mandatory IBF position to face Lamont Peterson. And I say Lamont Peterson because regardless if Lamont Peterson loses to Lucas Matisse, he's still the champion because this fight is being contested at a catchweight of 141. So he's going to keep his title, man. Whether you guys like it or not, he's still going to be champion. Even though I don't have him losing, but it is what it is. We got to talk about Vic Darchinian. I believe he got a 4th-round knockout. It was a shootout, so we got to touch on that. And it seems like Vic Darchinian might be pointed in the direction of Guillermo Rigondeaux. Really bad matchup for him. We got another request here from Mr. Grundy, Carlos Grundy. So you're all set. You could definitely call us up. But yeah, what's your thoughts on Darchinian versus Guillermo Rigondeaux? Do you feel that the style of Guillermo Rigondeaux may make Darchinian look good because he's so settled and waits for the counter? Would Darchinian's constant pressure, straight left hand, be a problem for Guillermo, or would it be a counter fest? We also got to talk about, for everybody over the pond, Jamie McDowell. He fought for a vacant IBF title versus Julio Sia. We got to talk about that, of course. Vinny Mandalone was fighting out in Huntington, New York. You know, we got a few things we could definitely discuss, man. But once again, the number is 1-201-688-7127. And you can Skype us absolutely free at The Boxing Voice, THA Boxing Voice. So I guess we should just move on. I mean, I was trying to make time for Vic, man. But the first thing on my agenda is to talk about Ricky Burns. You know, I'm smiling for those that are not watching us live on YouTube, because I'm actually going to try and pull up that comment on my phone, just not to, you know, disrupt the sound of the show. But somebody, and I'm going to get his name, really took a shot at me and was talking how Ricky Burns would beat Broner. And, you know, I don't know shit about boxing. Ricky Burns is this, Ricky Burns is that, and the other. So I'm going to go ahead and pull this comment up. Let me see here. Here we go. Check this out, guys. Ricky Burns is class and would definitely be a test for Broner. Burns is a great boxer and could take a punch and get off the canvas and win. The first world title he won, and mind you guys, he spelled one instead of W-O-N. He spelled it O-N-E, like the number one. And you guys talk about me for my Mexico thing, but okay. Was at super featherweight. He got put on the canvas against Rocky Martinez. Mind you, we all know Rocky Martinez is like a journeyman. But anyway, and got up off the floor and outboxed Martinez. Watch Burns tonight against Jose Gonzalez, and you'll see what a great fighter Burns is. And he's not cocky. He's a real fighter who is down to earth. Looks like we're having some difficulties here on Mixler, but it seems to be back working, I think. Let me check those comments on Mixler. Somebody, if you can still hear me on Mixler, let me know. I'm checking the comments now. You know, every so often, everything is gonna have its issues. Let me just take this off. So anyway, did I just see somebody say Burns proved in his win that he can take an ass whooping? Ray Gamboa, man, I fucks with you, dude, but you're bugging. How are you going to say he proved? What'd he prove? I think the fight went up to 9 rounds, and it was 7-2. Gonzalez, he quit because of his hand. I mean, look, I'm not giving anybody credit for quitting. You know, he should have rocked out for another 9 minutes and got a win. But he was pitching a shutout. Burns was coming on, and that was because Gonzalez's hands was hurt when he tried to take out Burns in the seventh round. Are you kidding me? Giving him credit for what? For getting a gift decision? That's what it was. What the hell is Lex Luger talking about here? He says Burns been training for fights that got canceled twice. Must have had an effect. Oh, man. Stephen Redshaw, knock it the fuck off. I mean, I don't understand why these guys make so many fucking excuses for fighters, man. Bao, what's going on, Bao? Talk to me, man. Talk. And please, don't be biased because you're from the UK. Keep it real. Burns look like shit.
Yo, you know me, man. I always keep it real, Nez, man. Definitely. Look, let me tell you something now. First of all, no one went out there. I've got proof. Again, I'll bring it to the fore, man. I predicted Gonzalez to win this. You with me, bro?
You predicted Gonzalez to win this?
Yeah, man. I predicted Gonzalez to win this. I'll show you emails. They've got dates on them. And I broke the fight down and I predicted Gonzalez to win this. My only concern for Gonzalez was whether he could take a punch, A, and B, if he could go the distance, like stamina-wise, right? His conditioning. That was my only concern. I've done some research on him. I understand that he only turned pro like in 2008. I think he'd been in prison before that. He was a street fighter. I watched some of his fights and I saw the way he fights, how calm he is in the ring and so on, man. Man, he schooled Burns. He absolutely schooled him. It was like...
Wait, Bao, I gotta say this, man. I just seen like 10 consecutive comments on Mixler, and that's Mixler.com/TheBoxingVoice if you want to join our live chat, or you could go on The Boxing Voice YouTube /TheBoxingVoice to join that live chat. But man, I got Ness, I was being sarcastic. Relax. Burns is a bum. Burns is a bum. Burns is another con. Burns is a bum times 10. Ricky Bums.
You know what? Man, I think that's been a little bit harsh.
At least I'm not the only one.
A little bit harsh on him because I think if anything, in the I think he was in the sixth or seventh round when he was really hurt, man. He was hurt big time. And from the start of the fight, Nez, you know, Gonzalez. Did you watch the fight, right? Gonzalez with his left, right, bang right into the body, man, right into the center all the time. And Burns was taking some heavy shots and punishment. He was reaching for thin air.
But Bao,
I didn't give him any
Bao,
round.
Wait,
I gave him
wait,
one
Bao,
round.
Wait, Bao. Bao. This is the problem. Who the fuck is Gonzalez? He let Gonzalez do that to him.
Yeah,
this
but
was
Nez,
supposed
you know,
to be
sometimes...
a tune-up fight under the new Matchroom Promotions. This wasn't supposed to be a life-or-death fight that he could have lost if the man didn't quit.
Yeah, Nez,
even if Gonzalez would have lasted the other 9 minutes,
yeah, but
it would have been
7-5.
He lost.
That's what's beautiful about boxing, though. Sometimes you're going to get a matchup. Sometimes you're going to get like this. We always know stars make fights. Sometimes you're going to get a matchup like this, where the opponent, you don't know much about him, he's underestimated. First of all, he's from Puerto Rico, man. There's great boxing heritage there, right? And as I say, I've got some of his fights anyway. I've got about four fights of his full fights on tape anyway. And just like as just, you know, got them in there in the collection. And I just thought as a stylistic, I wanted to know who was the matchmaker in this fight, because I'll tell you now, but he should have gone, oh man, if the wrist and that, man, I was good, because honestly, that's what I predicted. I said Gonzalez is going to win this. But Ricky Burns showed that he's a level below. But then again, you know, with Broner, I don't think Broner's all that anyway. Look, I've got, look at this as a statement, and if you can hear me on this one, Nez, right? You know Mayweather, think of him. Look at his body type. Think of him as a 1,500-meter runner, okay? And then think of Broner as a 100-meter sprinter. You with me?
Okay. Yes.
You with me? Right? I see a fight with Burns. It's a matchup of styles. A fight with Ricky Burns. Even though, look, Ricky Burns can take a shot. If he lacks in skill and if he lacks in boxing fundamentals, he makes up in heart. Now that ain't gonna win you. Ain't gonna win you many fights down the line. But as a matchup with Broner and Ricky Burns, I think first six rounds, Broner would absolutely be walking it. He'd be walking it. But then after that, going into deep waters, I think that's where a fight could be made. A fight could really be made. And rounds 10 and 11, 12 there, body type of Broner, like I said, he looks to me a bit like a 100-meter sprinter. Where like a Mayweather with Guerrero, he looked like a 1,500-meter runner. He can go the distance a little bit.
Yeah, but, Bal, my thing is the level of opposition that a Gonzalez was, you can't even – once you compare Broner and Burns in a fight, the shots that Gonzalez landed on him, Broner would have knocked him out. I mean –
You reckon?
If we don't know anything about Broner, we know he could punch.
Well, did you hear the shots that bloody Gonzalez was landing? Man, they was like...
Doesn't matter. Punch, Gonzalez man. Never knocked out world-class fighters.
Yeah, I know. Well, where do you see Gonzalez going forward then? After what you've seen of him now, okay, after what the world of boxing then has seen of Gonzalez, where do you think he can go forward? Do you think he has a future or what do you think?
Me personally, I would like to see him get back in the ring. I would like to see him give another crack at it. I know he left a sour taste in everybody's mouth by quitting, but we don't know how serious that hand injury was.
I think it was a broken wrist.
Yeah, they said wrist. They said hands. You know what I have a problem with? I have a problem with the commentators lying, saying that Ricky Burns took Gonzalez's heart.
Oh, that's
the
bullshit.
Dude had two rounds of success,
bullshit.
Man.
Yeah, I know. That is a load of rubbish. That's what I mean. That's like media propaganda, man. It's like they just tried to. They saw an angle and they didn't just jump on it. They rided it like nothing. Oh man, yeah, that was wrong. That was wrong. I still, like I said, I think Ricky Burns. I predicted Gonzalez to win. I was wrong. I didn't think Gonzalez would, not finish the fight. I think he would have struggled, but Ricky Burns, he's got a lot to prove because, like I said, I didn't give him any rounds. I gave him one round at most. That was it.
Yeah, man, I agree with you. I gave him the two rounds. I gave him 8 and 9, but, based on what I seen of Ricky Burns versus this guy who's a nobody, I think that Broner shouldn't get any slack for not making that fight, even though it wasn't his fight. It was his fault, excuse me.
Ricky Burns didn't want to make it. Him.
Exactly, and for good reasons.
We'll see. Broner's got a lot to prove as well. You know my thoughts on that anyway. But, Nez, what about...
Wait a minute. You're going to tell me what you've seen of Broner and what you've seen of Burns. You don't know how that fight would turn out?
Yeah, I've got a feeling that if both were on the A game, like I said, I think if Burns can withstand the power and if it's a neutral playing field and we got a proper fair fight, then I think I think rounds 10, 11, and 12 will be the most important in that. That will decide the fight for me. Because I'm not convinced with Broner, as you know. I think he'll have issues. Like I said, body type. He's like a Jeff Lacy. He reminds me of a Jeff Lacy. He's like so power built, man. He's like, he looks so big. Like, he's explosive to start out. And like I mentioned before, Quintero, De Leon, and other fights, where he got tagged with, Gavin Reese tagged him. He tagged him. And I think the only problem that Burns would have is trying to get to him with a jab and a reach. But if he makes it a brawl, if he turns it into a brawl and he's got to do that from round three.
How can a man with no firepower make it a brawl? Come on, Bal.
Well, no, it's got to be. Well, without firepower, you can't rely on one shot. You can't rely on one shot. If you've got the firepower, you don't need to turn it into a brawl, really, because you can rely on your one shot, like, to take someone out. With Ricky Burns, he's got, I think he's got the chin. He seems as though he's got the chin. He's got the heart, as they say. But I think he needs to get in there, get in the chest, really rough it up, make it a rough house, and then really, you know, put his weight on, whatever weight. I don't even think the fight's going to happen, to be fair. I think now Brown has gone up to 147. He's still at 135, 140. I don't think the fight's going to happen. So, but yeah, I think if the fight was to happen.
Bal, give us a call a little later. You rocked out for 10 minutes. Let me free up the lines and move on with the headlines. We're going to stick on this Burns topic just because I got some interesting news to tell everybody, okay?
Okay, before you go, will you do...
Sorry about that, Bal. But I'll get you on your second call. So Ricky Burns versus Miguel Vasquez is going to be possibly put together for September. I don't see how Ricky Burns is going to be Vasquez. I just don't see it. He has showed, relentlessness. He does keep coming forward. He was getting hit with some shots yesterday, and he kept coming. He kept trying to make it a fight. I just don't know how he's going to be able to catch up to Miguel Vasquez, who's a good counterer and a great mover and has a great reach. So Chuelo gave this guy all types of problems just for having a good reach and some pop. No movement, though. He was there to be hit. And he swung some really wide right hands. Miguel Vasquez is a bit more fundamentally put together. But call us up, 1201-688-7127. We got 9 minutes before our first guest, which is Juan Manuel Lopez. But let me know, what do you think about Miguel Vasquez versus Ricky Burns, based on what you've seen, based on what we know? I mean, I guess the biggest puncher he's faced is Michael Cassidy's and now Gonzalez. But again, Gonzalez was unproven. He hadn't knocked out any world-class fighters. Say what you want about Broner. He stopped DeMarco. He stopped Litsau. He went 12 with Ponce, whether you feel he lost, like I had him losing by 2 rounds. I don't know. I mean, it's a waste of time to talk about that. So call in and talk about Vasquez versus Burns, because Broner's moving up. He's got a fight. He had a press conference. He's in training. He's going to be fighting Paulie Malignaggi. But, you know, Eddie Hearn, he's a great promoter. I like him. We love him over here. But he's looking to match up Burns with Vasquez for a unification bout for the IBF championship. I got my co-host here, Victor Salazar. Vic, what's going on, brother? Vic, you there? Victor. All right, well, let's just leave Vic on the line in case he does happen to want to say anything. But so in the news, you know, we got this Vasquez Burns.
Can I go to PS3?
I think this will probably be Burns' toughest test. Do you guys agree with me?
Why? I'm not
Vic, are you there? I'm going to let Vic go and just text him. See what's going on. So, yeah, man, definitely call us up. All right, here goes Vic. Vic, what's up?
What's up, man? I'm having technical difficulties from phones,
no, but
internet.
You know, you're calling me. You're calling me on a video call. Don't do that. Just call. I'll call you back. How about that?
All right.
Vic is a technology challenged over
here. Yo.
You see how much better you sound? You were doing a video call. Yeah, I hear you.
Yeah, I don't know. All right. I don't know. I'm still working on the internet, but whatever. I'm on now. What's up, man?
Well, we're just talking Ricky Burns versus Gonzalez and the fact that Gonzalez gave Ricky Burns a gift win because Ricky Burns only really had won the 8th and the 9th round, and that's because Gonzalez either hurt his hand or broke his wrist. But now Eddie Hearns is saying he wants to match up IBF champion Miguel Vasquez, the puppet, should be known as the puppeteer because he gets people to do exactly what he wants by pulling on their strings in boxing. And I think it's disaster for Ricky Burns.
And I mean,
everybody who was just
if we learned one thing yesterday,
Burns and Burns.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, I was just saying, everybody who was talking this Burns Broner fight and how Broner should have fought Burns, I guess last night was clear evidence of Broner not having to fight Ricky Burns because the outcome was inevitable.
Well, I guess there's a reason that Frank Warren didn't want it at 130 or 135, and it's pretty clear. Miguel Vasquez, we'll get into that later, how disappointed I am. I'm not Miguel Vasquez, Jose Gonzalez. How disappointed I am with what he did yesterday, and I'm sure a lot of fans, Puerto Ricans or not, are disappointed in what he pulled yesterday. But yeah, Ricky Burns was a little exposed yesterday. Jose Gonzalez has a nice long jab. I think his reach was something like 71 or 72 or something like that. And say what you want, he gave it all in the seventh round. I don't know what happened, whether it was he wanted to go for the knockout or whatever, but something happened in that seventh round, and it was never the same for him. But Ricky Burns, if you got a long jab, what can you do? What can Ricky Burns do to negate that? And Miguel Vasquez is a more accomplished boxer than Jose Gonzalez. So if that fight happens, I mean, say what you want about Puppet. He might be born. He might be this. He might be that. But the boxing skills are on the level of Jose Gonzalez, if not three or four times better than that. So I don't know, man. Ricky's got his work cut out for him.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. Ricky Burns showed that he was unable to come up with another game plan. He just kept coming forward and getting tagged. Look, man, the whole reason that we're even on this conversation is because someone, you know, took a shot at me on our last show, and I read their comment on this show, and they wanted me to watch Ricky Burns fight Gonzalez, and I did. And all I could come up with is two words. Euro bum.
I knew that was coming.
A dude who's being protected. A dude that has tried to make a dude that was offered the biggest fight of his career, not once, not twice, but three times. And then you still got these European fans defending him. Oh, why he never fought Burns? Why he never fought Burns? He's moving up to fight Malignaggi. Man, stop fucking crying, man. What the baby's gonna do? Your man ain't shit. Dude, who is Chelo Gonzalez, Vic?
I'm not gonna lie to you. I had actually picked an upset in this fight. And I said it on Twitter that Chelo Gonzalez is a better boxer than Roman Martinez, and he was gonna give this guy fits. And I didn't mind picking the upset. So I was looking good for seven rounds.
But Vic, what fights have you seen of Chelo Gonzalez?
I've seen some YouTube clips where he does go to the body. He does use that long jab. And this is 135. It's not 130. So I just seen him as a better boxer than Rocky Martinez. Rocky Martinez is one guy. All he knows how to do is fucking brawl. You saw from Chelo, he knows how to use that jab. He can go to the body. And I thought, man, Jesus. I'm like, oh, shit. Here comes Puerto Rico. We're going to have another champion. And then ninth round comes. I don't know what happens.
I'll tell you what happened. He hurt his fucking hand. He should have just rode out the 9 minutes. He would have still got a 7-5 win. But we're live with, the one, the only. It's a man. Sean, what's good, baby?
It's the maniac. What's going on, fellas?
Chilling, baby.
Man, I
know you got a lot to say, but try to keep it short, man. We're gonna have one mind a little bit, so.
Yeah. Nah, you know, man, the only thing that bothered me was that, you know, people started labeling on Twitter. What happened?
Vic, did you text Wyman and let him know the number they could be calling him?
Yeah, I told him 201. I told him 201.
Hello.
Yeah, go ahead, Sean.
Yeah, I just was upset with the Puerto Ricans being associated with quitting. Like, since when? Since when Puerto Ricans are quitters? Okay, so I mean, Chad Dawson quit against Andre Ward, so all black fighters are quitters now. DeMarco quit against Roma. All Mexicans are quitters.
DeMarco ain't quit against Broner.
I mean, we could go on the list as far as a bunch of fighters from every ethnicity that's quit. So to say, to associate Puerto Ricans with quitting is ridiculous. And one, you know, if he quit, he didn't get quit from a beating. And I know that's why a lot of people's upset. Yes, I agree. If you want to become a champion, you have to go through adversity. Nothing comes easy. You got to fight with one hand. So be it. You understand? And that kind of bothers me. But it's not like he got his ass whooped and he quit. Yeah.
Sean, let me give you a call back, and I promise that I will. But we were scheduled for 7:30 with Juanma.
I got it. All right. No problem. All right. Cool.
Now, let me see if I'm going to be able to. Vic, you might have to call back in if I can't merge you. Let's try this. Vic, you still there?
Lo sentimos. Usted ha obtenido un número que no está en servicio. Por favor, consulte.
Live on the Box Voice. Who's this?
So if they Puerto Rican quitters, Cotto quit against Margarito.
This is Liam.
Segura.
Liam. Look, and he hung up again. This dude is mad. He's wild gay, yo. Every time he calls, he hangs up, man. He is the funniest. I can't believe him, man. Let me get back on Vic. Vic, you there? I think Vic. All right, let's try and get one more on here. I dialed that wrong. Yo, you guys heard Liam, man. We got to get Liam's number. We're going to have to do a reverse call on him, dude. He's out of control with this calling in and getting his point across and then hanging up.
Lo sentimos.
And I did that wrong, too. What is wrong with this dude? Okay, that should work, right? Let me see. Yep, this is it.
Lo sentimos. Usted ha obtenido un número que no está en servicio. Por favor, consulte su guía y trate de nuevo.
Why is this not working? Oh, maybe I gotta press one. Man, I know you guys. Bear with me, man. Bear with me. Vic giving me these international numbers over here. That shit. Still, that's. I don't get this. Vic.
Yo.
Yeah, man, I can't get this thing to work, brother. You're gonna probably have to call him. I'm trying. I'm gonna try one more time here.
Try and call him. If not, I'll try. I don't know, man.
Oh, man. Yo.
Yo.
Vic.
Yeah.
Yeah, nah, I'm not getting it to work. I don't know. It just keeps saying it's the wrong number, but it's not. I'm dialing it the right way.
Can I call in, like, from my cell phone and merge them?
Hold on. Yeah, you can do that, but let me try one more time. I just put the calling. calling code on its own. Let me see. There we go. All right, you can hear me? Vic, call back in. Hello?
Se ha comunicado con número son 7.
Yeah, Vic, you're going to have to text him. I got his voicemail.
All right.
So moving along, since we're talking lightweights, let's go a couple of divisions under and talk a little bit more about Victor Chinian. He came back, I believe it was in Laredo, Texas. Gangland over there. Borderline of Mexico and whatnot. But what he did with this win was put himself in title contention again. You know, I believe that Guillermo has all the belts, if I'm not mistaken, or maybe two. But somehow or another, Darchinian is currently ranked at number two with the WBC, number seven with the IBF, number one with the WBO. And the current WBO champion and Lino World Junior Featherweight champion is Guillermo Rigondeaux. So it looks like we're going to be getting that fight. And I know I touched on it a little bit in the show notes, but I think that we have to take a step back and not be upset that this fight is going to be made because, honestly, other than Leo Santa Cruz, who's left at 122? I mean, if you think about Moreno, then maybe, but Moreno's golden boy, so you know that's not happening. So I guess a Vic and Guillermo fight isn't a bad thing. I wouldn't mind it. It'll definitely be, you know, an exciting fight because we all know that Vic's going to come to make that fight happen one way or another. There's no date set as of yet. Oh, brother. Vic gave me another number to call. Vic, you still live with me or what?
Yeah. He just texted me to give another number to call.
Okay, let me try it. So take over the floor so we don't have no dead air.
Well, I seen Vic Darchinian fight. He got stunned a little bit in that fight. And, I mean, do I want to see Darchinian and Rigo? Yeah, why not? But I think it's a little one-sided at this point. But, I mean, who's Rigo going to fight at 122? I don't think there's anything else left for him. He's not fighting Santa Cruz. I mean, he might be in there with Cesaro or something like that, but there isn't much for him.
All right, you guys not hearing Vic because I'm going to have to make this call. Okay, te habla Néstor de parte del Boxing Voice y en par de minutos se va a conectar el compañero mío, Víctor Salazar, que habló contigo para hacer esta entrevista.
Sí, claro.
Bueno, yo quiero esperarlo a él para que yo pueda traducirle al público, porque tenemos el público que habla en inglés.
Ok.
Pero dame un minuto para hablar con el público. All right, guys, so we're live definitely with Juan Manuel Lopez. As you can see, I will have to translate, so I'm waiting for Victor Salazar to call in whenever he gets the time. Text him a bunch. You guys need to hit him up and see if we can get this thing going because I can't talk both languages. But we're definitely live with former champion of the WBO, Juan Manuel Lopez, and I guess I'm gonna be forced to start alone. So, Juanma, te quiero preguntar, ¿cómo te sientes ahora? ¿Sabes que va a tener esta pelea con Mikey García? ¿Qué es lo que te está pasando por la mente sabiendo que ya tú vas a confrontarte con un campeón que es un boxeador bien técnico?
No, bien, no, bien tranquilo, confiado en el trabajo que se está haciendo en el gimnasio. y sobre todo bien confiado en mi experiencia. Era un gran peleador, muy técnico, muy inteligente, pero mi experiencia es mucha también, y yo siempre bien fuerte, que es cuestión de hacer el trabajo como se ha practicado.
Okay, so first and foremost, guys, I asked him, you know, how's he feeling, and how does he feel that he's going to be facing Mikey Garcia, you know, a very technical boxer. So he says that he feels very comfortable because of his experience, and, you know, they've been working, and he feels really good, and he thinks he's ready to go. Juanma, ¿cómo? Espera un minuto. Well, so I'm going to ask some guys, how did this fight come about? Because we all know that he suffered two losses, so I want to know how did he get back in title contention.
He contradicts himself. No.
You hear me or no? I don't hear you, though.
Yeah, I hear you. You hear me?
Yeah, I hear you. What's up?
All right. Go ahead. Take it over with Juanma. He's on the line.
Hola, Juanma. ¿Cómo está hoy?
Todo bien, todo bien. Gracias a Dios. Bien, bien. Tengo una actividad con los familiares, pero atendiendo como siempre a todos ustedes.
Bueno, Juanma, vamos a hacer la entrevista en inglés y en español, porque los que ponen atención al programa son en inglés. Pero yo voy a tratar a traducir, si no, ahí tengo mi compañero, él traduce bueno. Pero la primera cuestión, la primera pregunta quiero...
I'll translate.
You translate? All right. Well, yeah. The first question I want to ask him is, we spoke to him in AC, and he said he wasn't going below 128. Why the change to 126 with Mikey?
Él dice que la primera pregunta que te quiere preguntar es que cuando él habló contigo en Atlantic City, aquí en New Jersey, lo primero que tú le dijiste fue que tú no ibas a bajar para la 126, y ahora está haciendo esta pelea a la 126 con Mikey García.
No, nosotros en realidad no estoy de la 130 libras, ese es mi objetivo principal, pero nosotros hemos hecho ya dos peleas en 128, las negociaciones pues yo el interés de 126. Esto nos va a ser muy importante, muy interesante económicamente para la fanaticada. Pues nosotros pues decidimos hacer el sacrificio, pero yo creo que esta es la última pelea que hacemos en 126.
Okay. He says, you're right. His preferred weight is 130. He's fought, you know, between 128 to 130, but HBO offered this fight at 126. And economically, it makes a lot of sense for him and his team, and they've done the necessary preparations, and they feel that they'll be able to get to that weight, you know, without any problems. But it's more of an economical stance that they took this fight at that weight, Vic.
Now, speaking of making that weight, the rumors, or not even rumors, it's true, he's working with Alex Ariza. I mean, can he speak on how did it come to Alex Ariza and why he chose Alex Ariza for this fight?
Él dice, hablando sobre el peso, el público se ha dado cuenta que ahora tú estás trabajando con Alex Ariza, que era el strength and conditioning coach de Manny Pacquiao, y él quiere saber cómo esa relación se formó y por qué te fuiste con Alex Ariza sobre tanta otra gente que hay en el negocio de boxeo que hacen strength and conditioning, como un Angel Heredia y varios otros.
No, realmente no estamos hablando con Ariza. Fue una conversación que hubieron con Ariza, como también lo hubieron con Angel Heredia. Hubieron conversación con ambos, pero ambos en personal trainer están muy, muy ocupados con otros peleadores que ya tienen. Así que por esto que estamos así trabajando con mi equipo de trabajo, normalmente como lo hemos hecho, lo que pasa es que eso fue una información que parece que se filtró y se adelantaron antes de tiempo, pero realmente no es como lo están diciendo.
So, ¿no es cierto que está trabajando con Alex Ariza?
No. Iba a trabajar, pero no se pudo llegar a un acuerdo. Porque él tiene otro pelea, él estaba con Chávez Junior y realmente no se pudo.
Okay. He says Alex Ariza is currently working with Julio Cesar Chavez Jr., and he was only in talks with Alex Ariza clearly something leaked out. It wasn't properly filtered, and the public believes that he's working with RZA. But he was also speaking with Heredia as well. But those guys are very busy with all the fighters that they have. So for this particular fight, they're not working with any strength and conditioning coach. They're going to do things the way they normally do it. They're just going to work a little bit harder.
So can you ask him what his weight is right now? And, I mean, does he feel that coming down to 126 will be something that might affect him in this fight with Mikey Garcia?
Bueno, Juanma, él quiere saber cuál es tu peso ahora mismo y si tú piensas que bajando para atrás para la 126 va a ser algo que te puede afectar en esta pelea contra Mikey García.
Ahora mismo estamos bajando 139 libras. Estamos a ley de creerse 14 libras solamente. Si hay que trabajar. Esperemos que no traiga problemas.
We can't hear you on YouTube, homie. Mm-mm. I can't hear you, dude. Mm-mm.
What about now?
I hear you now.
All right, he said that he's at the 139 weight. And that him and his team feel like if they work at a relaxed pace, they will get to the contracted weight of 126. And that's what they've been doing. They're already at 139 now. And they're this far out, so they feel that if they continue to work relaxed, they will get to that pace. Vic, before you proceed, when I get muted, it's because I'm typing. And I should be texting you this instead of saying it, but whatever. You're going to have to tweet out because I can't use my keyboard. Or I'm going to mute myself. All right.
So what I want to know next is, Garcia pretty much did damage on Salido. Salido beat him twice. Why does he feel he has a shot in this fight?
Él dice que su próxima pregunta es que Mikey García realmente le ganó a Orlando Salido. Bien fácil, como quien dice. Y tú perdiste dos veces contra Salido. So él dice, ¿por qué tú piensas que tú tienes una oportunidad para ganar en esta pelea sabiendo ya que el hombre que te ganó a ti, ahora tú vas a confrontar el hombre que le ganó a ese mismo hombre?
Los estilos son peleas. En la historia del boxeo a nivel mundial, pues, durante toda la historia del boxeo, pues, se ha visto que los estilos son peleas. Salido tengo un estilo muy complicado, que cada quien pelea con peleadores con ese estilo, pues, se me complica. Pero peleadores con estilo como lo es Mikey, pues se me hacen más, menos complicado. Así que porque le había ganado no significa que me haya ganado a mí. Eso no tiene nada que ver con la otra. Quien piensa eso, pues está erróneo. Esta pelea es más difícil de lo que muchas personas creen y nosotros estamos preparados para ganarle y lo vamos a demostrar el día 15 de junio.
Vicky says Styles makes fights. And anyone that's seen that fight knows that Orlando Salido is a very difficult style, and it was a difficult style for him. But the style that Mikey Garcia brings into the ring, he feels it's going to be more suitable for him. What I would like you to ask him is, does he feel that because Mikey Garcia is a patient fighter? Well, I guess I'm saying the question anyway, I'll just edit it as well. Well, I want to ask him, does he feel that because Mikey Garcia is a patient fighter, and while he has a lot of power, his knockouts don't come till late. Does he feel that that's what he's going to be able to take advantage? The fact that Mikey takes it easy 1-8, and he's not coming forward applying pressure on Juanma. Juanma, so la pregunta que yo te quiero preguntar es, ¿Por qué tú ves que Mikey García es un peleador paciente que tiene mucha fuerza, pero los knockouts de él vienen de como el asalto 8 hasta el 12? O sea, que él no te va a poner mucha presión y va a ser una pelea bien relajada. ¿Eso es lo que tú piensas?
No, la pelea no va a ser relajada. Es una pelea bien fuerte. No va a ser tan fuerte para él como para mí. Una pelea que iba a ser intensa, realmente así. Pero es un peleador que más definido, un peleador más técnico, que tira ya, tira recta, tira open gancho. No un peleador que tú estás esperando y sale con un volado, o estás esperando un open y sale con un gancho. Un peleador que es parecido a mí, que es técnico, no un loco. Cuadrilátero, y por eso es más fácil de llevar la pelea. Pero hoy repito, es cuestión de estilo, estás cortando los estilos.
Okay. Well, Vic, he says that he doesn't believe the fight is going to be relaxed or that Mikey's going to be patient. He feels it's going to be a very high intense fight. And, you know, again, basically the same thing, the styles make fights. So, you know, he's going to bring the fight to Mikey anyway.
Now, what I want to know is if he saw the Salido fight, and if he caught, you know, did he think anything of, not Mikey essentially quitting, but as far as, you know, Robert and Mikey, well, maybe more Robert, you know, not continuing after the clash of heads and the broken nose and so forth. And does he think maybe if he lands that one shot and if Mikey's in trouble, he won't continue?
Él quiere saber si tuviste la pelea contra Mikey García y Orlando Solido. Y si la viste, sí, sabiendo que ellos pararon la pelea por Mikey García romperse la nariz. Si tú piensas que si te llega a ti un momento en la pelea donde tú le puedes dar con una buena, un buen gancho o una buena trompa, si tú piensas que ellos van a cuitearse como vimos ayer con Chelo González.
Realmente no sabría decirte, realmente trabajo fue inteligente, un con mucha experiencia, pues, y decidió proteger a su pelea, o sea, que iban ganando. Realmente yo no voy pensando en que él tenga nadie fracturada, nada, estoy pensando en que tenga que hacer mi ritmo de pelea, pase lo que pase, y la domina. Realmente yo no me voy a ir por eso.
Okay. He says realistically he doesn't allow himself to believe any of that or think of any of that, Vic. He's looking for, you know, a solid fight, and he doesn't want to just assume that a fighter is going to do something that he may not do.
So I guess what I want to know is, let's say hypothetically he beats Mikey García. Number one, does he feel like he's an underdog in this fight, and a big underdog? And number two, does he stay at 126 and wait for Donaire, or does he move up to 130?
Él quiere saber si tú le ganas a Mikey García, si tú te vas a quedar en ese peso, y si tú piensas que si tú ganas, tú vas a esperar a Nonito Donaire para hacer una pelea con él.
Realmente va a depender de cómo marcamos la división. Si hago bien 126 libras, pues definitivamente pues, tal vez me pueda quedar una pelea más. Si no, no puedo parar a 130 libras. Yo lo puedo pelea, vamos a hacer este combate primero y luego entonces pues, sabremos qué haremos.
Vic, he said realistically he has to see how he feels at the weight again. So he really can't tell you, but if he doesn't feel good, he's going to move back up to 130.
Well, I guess the last thing I want to ask him before he might want to take over is if he saw that the Chelo fight, and what do you think about him retiring on the stool yesterday?
Él dice que su última pregunta es si tuviste la pelea de anoche contra Chelo González y Ricky Burns. ¿Y cuál es su opinión sobre Chelo González que se quitió?
Que bueno, anoche yo vi la pelea, yo puto de la pelea de Chelo. Chelo hizo una gran pelea, me entendió dominando la pelea. Le ayudó a
la lesión que tuvo, pues tuvo que parar la pelea realmente. Pues ellos sabrán lo que pasó, sabrán cuál es la lesión de ellos y sabrán qué sucedió, pero a mí entonces le iba ganando la pelea, lamentó mucho de ser un gran amigo mío, que lamento mucho que no haya podido ganar ese título del mundo.
Ok, bueno, Juanma, gracias por darnos este tiempo, no queremos coger más de tu tiempo y que tenga mucha suerte en esta pelea con Mikey García y esperamos tenerte en nuestro programa otra vez. Si quieres cogerte tiempo ahora para decirle algo a todos tus fanáticos y yo se lo traduzo.
No, gracias por el apoyo, que también de la pelea, o sea, una gran pelea, que los que no puedan estar en vivo, que la vean por el video y que muchas gracias por el apoyo siempre, que Dios los bendiga.
Ok, gracias, pase buena noche. All right, so basically he said that he felt that Chello was dominating the fight and that he put up a great fight and he felt bad that, you know, a friend of his was so close to winning the world title and couldn't bring it home. He says things happen. It is what it is. But he says to all his fans, you know, thank you for always backing him. Definitely tune into the fight that he's going to make it a grand fight, a grand battle. And if you can't be there live, to watch it on HBO. And he God blessed everyone. So there you go. Juan Manuel Lopez live in the flesh and now is gone. Vic, did you catch any of that?
Yeah, I caught it.
Okay. So that was our guest, fellas. Vic, I think that we should definitely touch on Derry Jean, man. Well, they pronounced it Derry Jean, like Jean-Claude Van Damme. So let's talk about Derry Jean and the fact that he's never faced anybody and now he's going to get this, you know, so-called, I don't know, title shot versus Lamont at 140. He becomes the IBF mandatory, but he's untested. And he looked good yesterday, but he looked good versus a guy with three losses who basically also never faced anybody. I mean, he's been a good sparring partner to the stars, but facing actual people, he has not.
Well, I guess, I don't know. If I had someone to fight for the 140-pound title, I wouldn't think Derry Jean would have been worthy if he had won that fight by decision. But, I mean, the way and the manner that he did, he certainly made a name for himself on Friday. With that being said, I mean, would you rather him jump in there with a Lamont Peterson? I know this is mandatory, and as Lamont says, you know, anyone who's earned a spot to fight for a mandatory position, you know, he respects that. But wouldn't you rather him fight like someone like a Mike Dash Jr. or a Kareem Mayfield or, I mean, even a Josie before he gets in there with Lamont Peterson? I mean, he certainly proved his case. He certainly made a case by the way he did it. I mean, if he would have won a boring decision or if he would have won, you know, a decision where it was like 7-5 or something like that, then maybe not. He certainly made a case for himself. But my standpoint is, I mean, this is the first time we've really seen him on TV. Do you want to see him against Lamont Peterson next? Should Lamont Peterson win? And let's say even if Lamont Peterson wins, does he have a bigger fish to fry than Danny Garcia?
Well, it doesn't even matter if Peterson wins or not. Remember, this fight is being fought versus Matisse at a catchweight of 141. No titles are on the line. So win or lose, Lamont is still the IBF champion. Now, I like what you're saying. I like your idea. I don't want to see it versus a Josie. Did a Josie show us some exciting things in the Lucas Matisse fight? Yes. But he hasn't fought enough top-tier opposition. So there's really no way to gauge Jean versus a Josie. If he beats a Josie, what does that really mean? All we know is that a Josie can't beat the top-tier type of fighter. We need a guy like Mike Dallas. And I'm not saying the Mike Dallas fight would be a more exciting fight. I'm not saying it'll be a more fan-friendly fight. I'm saying Mike Dallas has been against better opposition. So we know that if Dallas beats him, then Jean is not the goods. And if Jean beats Dallas, we know Dallas is the goods because Dallas is only lost to upper-level opposition. He lost to Lopez. We seen what Lopez was able to go on and do. Correct me if I'm wrong, too, because, damn, people come at me in the comments and 2 hours later, did Dallas lose to Lopez or did he squeak that decision?
Did Lopez tweak that decision? What are you saying?
Oh, who won question? That fight, Dallas or Lopez?
You got me there, man. You're going to have to box right that, baby.
Yeah, I don't even want to touch my keyboard, but you go ahead and check that. But all right, Dallas has been in there with Lopez. He's been in with names. I mean, if it was me and I was the matchmaker and it was a perfect world, I put him undefeated fighter versus undefeated fighter. Let's get Kareem Mayfield in there. But
I like Mayfield. Mayfield's making noise about Mike Dallas was KO'd in the seventh round by Josita Lopez.
All right, well, there you go. So if Jean beats Dallas, then we know he's at least a B-minus, B-level fighter because that's the type of fighters that have beat Mike Dallas. But with a Josie, we really don't have nothing because let's say Matisse is the goods and he blows out Lamont Peterson. Then we'll be categorizing Jean too high if he beats in a Josie because Matisse is the machine and he blew out Mike Dallas. You know what I'm saying? And he, you know, he really dominated the Josie. So I don't know. But forget about what happens next. What did you think of his performance?
I thought it was a good performance.
What did you think of him overall as a fighter?
I thought if he was going to put his name in that 140-pound title discussion, a decision wasn't going to be enough. And I mean, he left no doubt who was a better fighter between him and Mookie. When part Pendarvis, he knocked him out. Even after a clash of heads, even after a big gash in his right eye. I mean, you saw the blood; it was streaming. But I mean, I think he made his case for a title shot. Now, do I want to see that next? No, because who's Pendarvis? Is he on that upper tier level? Is he even on that Mike Dallas level? I mean, I don't know. But if it comes down to it, and I won't be mad at a Peterson-Jean fight, if that's what happens next. But I know Peterson, win or lose, if he wins, obviously, he wants that Danny Garcia fight. If he loses, I mean, I'm sure he's got options. Khan, he's got, you know, he's still got the belt. But if he wants to fight as mandatory, I'm not at all mad. Because I think Jean did what he had to do yesterday. I mean, not yesterday, but on Friday. He did what he had to do, and he did it in impressive fashion.
Let me ask you this. Do you feel that Steven Espinoza and Showtime would make this a Showtime Championship boxing fight for Lamont Peterson? And if Lamont loses to Matisse, would they still air this matchup on either Showtime Championship or Showbox? Would these two men get a return date on Showtime? I mean, clearly Lamont is going to come back because he's Golden Boy. Golden Boy is Showtime, is Sheldon Boy over there. So we know Lamont's going to get back, but is Derry Jean a good enough B-side to get Lamont back on the air with him, or do they make him just completely avoid the mandatory or give up the belt?
Well, I mean, let's be honest. I mean, at the beginning of the year, granted, there were injuries, but, I mean, some of the main events we saw were Lucas Matisse, Mike Dallas, Ishe Smith, Kanan Bundridge. So, I mean, if we're going to see Ishe Smith, Kanan Bundridge, who, in my opinion, aren't as skill-wise as good as Lamont Peterson, of course Lamont Peterson should get a return date. And, of course, Derry John earned his spot. If you don't think Derry John earned his spot, I mean, what else can I tell you? I mean, the dude went. He did what he had to do, and he did it in impressive fashion. He did it on Showbox. So don't you think that's an automatic graduation from the Showbox program to Showbox either championship boxing or a special edition of Showbox championship boxing? I'm sorry, Show championship boxing or special edition of whatever the hell, you know, Lucas Matisse, Mike Dallas was, because that wasn't a Show championship boxing. It was a special edition of something. So I think Derry John has earned it. And I think Lamont Peterson signing with Golden Boy. First fight on Showtime. Win or lose, he's back on Showtime.
Okay, so let's get into his fight, I noticed that he's like a right-hand bandit. I mean, he was just pawing with the left hand and threw like 40-something percent of power punches with the right hand. Do you think that he's limited? While he looked good, remember who he was fighting, and how would that style that we seen yesterday of a guy that's basically throwing power punches only with one hand live up versus the upper top tier fighters in the 140?
Well, I think he'd be an underdog against Lamont Peterson. But who knows? I mean, it's hard to say, man. I mean, we saw Friday, you know, there's a clash of heads. There was a big gash in his right eye. I mean, who knows? I mean, one hand or not, I mean, isn't one hand better than nothing? I mean, I wish Chello would have came out and fought with his left hand. Maybe we'd have another Puerto Rican world champion. So, that being said, I don't know. I can't gauge it because we still have to see Lucas and Lamont go at it and see what happens, because I frankly think that's going to be a war and it's going to be a good time. It's going to be a great fight. And, years of a career are going to be lost in both men's lives next Saturday, in my opinion.
All right, so let's move on to the undercard. We seen John Thompson versus Giovanni Rodriguez, another Puerto Rican letdown. John Thompson coming from Irvington, New Jersey, right next door to my hometown. But another guy that seems very limited and seems to have a lot to still work on. Keeping his chin out there, swinging wild punches, wanting to hit when being hit. You know, like, and when I say that, I mean he had that style. Like, you hit me, I gotta hit you back. Not you hit me, I'm gonna look for an opening and get you back for that. You know, instead, you know, just turn it into a schoolyard fight. What was your thoughts on the undercard? How let down were you that a Trinidad-trained, you know, fighter in Giovanni Rodriguez didn't live up to, I guess, the hype of the last name in his trainer and, you know, I guess whatever you want to call it, because he had some sort of ties to Trinidad's father or cousin or something like that, and they tried to use that as a promotional ploy.
But he wasn't the favorite in this fight. I mean, I don't think he was. And the way fight week was going, the press releases I got weren't on Rodriguez. There was nothing to do with him. He was just a guy with an undefeated record. So for anyone to expect, I mean, well, we didn't expect Chello to do what he did anyway. But for anyone to expect an upset or, you know, a Puerto Rican renaissance from Giovanni Rodriguez, I mean, you're just fooling yourself. But, yeah, Trinidad was in the corner.
Yeah, but keep in mind this, Vic. It's not like you receive this overwhelming Puerto Rican press release or releases from so many people. You got to remember, you know, without saying any names, who is Thompson's publicist? And that's why you've seen so much on him, you know?
Yeah, but even if, I mean, Eddie Hearn and his team did a good job of selling Jose Gonzalez because press releases were coming in and out about this Jose Gonzalez saying that and this and that. And granted, maybe if they're trying to sell Chello as a credible opponent, which he was. I just didn't get that from Giovanni Rodriguez. So, am I disappointed he lost? I mean, I didn't think much of him. So, hey, it's a show box. I mean, somebody's always got to go, and it was Giovanni Rodriguez's.
All right, so before we move on to the rest of the weekend fights, let's get to this voicemail from one of our, listeners.
Should Sergio Martinez retire? Isn't he too old already? Isn't his age catching up? Is it over for him? Is it over? Is it the last thing? Does he got one more fight in him? Or will he end up knocked out in his last fight? What will happen?
So, basically the caller's asking, Should Sergio Martinez retire? Will he be knocked out in his next fight? Your thoughts, Vic?
Well, it depends on who he fights. It's tough to say, man, because it's hard for a guy his age that relies on reflexes and speed. And if those things are gone, and if he can't even train to move, if his knee is that bad, it all depends. I mean, who do you want to see Sergio Martinez in against next? If Chavez and Murray's fight for an interim title, then guess what? The winner of that is going to get Martinez. And I think if it's the same Sergio Martinez that was in the ring of Martin Murray faces Chavez with a 20-whatever-pound advantage, Chavez has a better shot. But, I mean, what other middleweight do you think Sergio, credible middleweight, not someone that's, you know, outside of the top seven, top eight, that Sergio can whitewash now? I mean, Brian.
I'll give you two suggestions. I say that, and I'll probably get a lot of shit for this, but if Sergio takes a well-needed rest, heals properly, with all the power that Peter Quillin brings into the ring, we seen Nick Dam land a lot of punches. We seen Guerrero land a lot of left hands. And that Sergio Martinez marquee punch. I think that he can throw his name back to the top, and it's already at the top. But people feel and have doubts on him. I think that he can beat Peter Quillin. I think that Peter Quillin has just as much as a shot to beat Martinez because of the power and the fact that we've seen Martinez go down so many times as of late. But if he can give another Chavez performance where he could keep the fight on the outside for 11 out of 12 rounds, he can probably beat Peter Quillin, unify, and everybody will be saying he's great again.
But
that's,
you know,
one suggestion.
But before you go to your second, do you know Peter Quillin has dropped his last 30 opponents a total of 10, 11 times? And, I mean, Martinez was dropped by Matt Macklin. Martinez was dropped by Martin Murray. I think Kidd's got a little more pop in those hands than both those guys.
I agree with you 100%. That's why I'm giving Peter Quillin just as much as a shot to beat Sergio. But he gets hit a lot. And he got hit with like five straight left hands in a sixth round of the fight versus Guerrero. If he gets hit with two straight left hands by Martinez, it might be rock-a-bye, baby.
Hey, guys, can you hear me?
I know that you're there. Yeah, I hear you. Just give us a minute, all right? Because we got one more voicemail to get to, and I want to make next suggestion for Sergio Martinez, which is another unification bout, Vic, which would be Daniel Gill. I think that that's another winnable fight because Gill doesn't bring overwhelming power to a fight. He brings relentlessness. He comes forward, and he makes the fight, but that also plays into the hand of a counterpuncher like Martinez. He won't have to come forward to make the fight like he did with Murray. Remember, a lot of the reasons that he looked so bad was because Murray wasn't coming forward as much as fighters are used to coming forward when they fight a Sergio Martinez. Gil will fall right into that. Plus, you'll have that European high guard, which would allow Martinez to win on activity. Your thoughts, Vic?
Well, I don't know, because I think at the end of the day, Kid Chocolate already called out Daniel Gill. I'd favor Martinez against Gill, absolutely. But I don't know. I'd favor Martinez against Gill, obviously. But there's only one guy calling out Gill right now that has a title, and that's Peter Kid Chocolate Quillin. And Gail's soon to pick an opponent. So who knows? I mean, I want to see Gail Kid Chocolate, to be honest with you, because Kid Chocolate's middleweight pool of opposition is so limited because he's with Showtime that Gil fits into that realm of who we can fight. But who knows, because HBO still owes Gary Shaw and Daniel Gill a middleweight fight. So do we have to wait another year to see Daniel Gill in there? Or would you rather see Daniel Gill against Kid Chocolate September in Brooklyn or somewhere else?
Good point, good point. And Bal, before we go to you, we're going to go to this other voicemail.
No problem, man.
So what happened in the TNT Lowry fight versus Rainmaker Melson back on April 27th? Who won?
Vic, I guess that's an easy one for you to answer. Just pull it up. You know I can't touch my keyboard. Just give me a nod when you got that pulled up. Bao Kang, take it away.
Yeah, man, just talking about the Martinez there. I think with Sergio Martinez's style, it's like Roy Jones Jr. You know, he's old now. He relies a lot on his legs, the way he fights and stuff. It's leg-dependent. He relies on that elusiveness. And I just think that the best move for Martinez now would be really maybe to get one more big fight if he could really get in full condition. I know there was injuries involved, I think, in the Murray fight, and he didn't want to let the fans down. But for me, I think it's the end of the line for Martinez, man.
All right, Bout. So we're gonna go ahead and let you go. We got another caller on the line.
But
give us a call back.
Boy,
go ahead.
Boy Melson won a decision. But go ahead, Bout. Okay.
Yeah, I just want to also just say as well, man. Look, guys, you've got a fantastic show there, right? And the whole world hears it. You know, I keep hearing that, oh, this fight can't be made because of this promoter, or he's with Showtime, or he's with Top Rank, and I feel that, and we know that's what's going on. But surely as fans, right, and you guys, as I say, I mean, I'm putting the weight on you here now, because you've got a fantastic show. We've got to stand up and say, well, actually, no, we've got to rebel a little bit here. We want to see fights being made. So doesn't matter about the promoters. If the fans can stand up a little bit and just say, well, we want these fights to be made because these are the best fights that should happen, then we should stand up for that. And I think we should promote that you guys should promote that on the show and not just like kind of fall in line and conform and say, well, no, that can't be made because he's with Top Rank or Golden Boy or Showtime or HBO. Forget that. Oscar De La Hoya versus Felix Tito Trinidad was made, and Trinidad was with Don King, and I think he was with De La Hoya, with Bob Arum. Both undefeated. Fight was made. Regardless how it turned out, fight was made because of the fans. So I think with a fantastic show that you guys have got, we should promote that, and we should, you guys should voice that these fights be made and not let that thing be an obstacle. But that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Great point, Bao. But
I think that's a fair point. I think we should maybe we should make a point of it when we go to these open workouts and when we call these promoters. Instead of saying, oh, we know this fight can't happen, we should be like, well, why isn't this fight happening? Why can't we make it happen? I mean, maybe,
exactly.
I'm just saying. I know. We try, though. You
got to
give us the onus. We try.
Sugar Ray Leonard and Roberto Duran were in Dallas, I believe, a couple of days ago. And they were asked about Mayweather, and they gave him good respect. Don't get me wrong, they gave him good respect. It's online. But what they did say, they go, we weren't scared. We weren't scared. Don't be afraid. It was like, how much, when, where, what weight? Get it on.
Now, but you see, the problem with that is everything you're saying is right. But in order for something like that to happen, the boxing fans as a whole would have to boycott. And because boxing is not as, I guess, accessible to us as we would like it to be,
I hear you.
I don't see many boxing fans boycotting any specific fights.
Yeah, I know. We're still gonna watch them, but I think
or their
yeah. But no, I think we should still do it. We should try
the big fight. And let me tell you another thing. When you got these guys like Oscar De La Hoya and Bob Arum at press conferences, you could check my videos on The Boxing Voice, you know, on YouTube / The Boxing Voice.
Yeah, I watch them. You do a great
questions
job.
Questions like that.
I know. You put it straight up there. You put them in a position where they have to answer the question, and I feel that. I love it.
But the thing with that is sometimes you turn them off, and especially not De La Hoya, but Bob Arum would definitely give you that look or even come out and say, like, do you even cover this sport? Because we know the answers as to why these fights are not being made. But I can't drag it on anymore. I got Young Link on the line,
cool.
And that's Link. Take it away, Link.
Man, yeah, it's Link from Atlantic City. I think Sergio just need to hang him up.
Man, let me find out. That was your voicemail we played.
Oh, no, nah, I didn't leave one this year, this week. It was last week for Canelo. But, I think he just need to hang him up. If he want one more payday, he don't need a title. You know what I mean? He could vacate the title and look for a big name and retire. But I think he just need to hang him up. He lost it. If the next fight is for the interim title, I don't think Sergio beats Chavez again. Because the first time he beat Chavez didn't know that he couldn't be hurt by him. Now Chavez knows he can't hurt him, and he won't load up on everything anymore.
But you want him to hang it up off of one bad fight, dude? How many great fights did he give us straight?
How long ago?
Huh?
Hey, I'm looking to hear something about the mama's boy, Dennis Douglas. You know what I'm saying? Because
almost lost.
Cat.
My bad, guys. That was a voicemail I'm queuing up, and it played up. It played by mistake. But go ahead.
But I said Chavez is not the fastest guy, and he almost lost. Let's just say from now on, he's gonna have to go 12 rounds. I don't think he can go 12 rounds single timeout anymore. I think he just need to hang him up. We didn't even hear about Mark before now, and now we're giving him all praise for dropping him twice. I count the second drop because he got dropped.
I mean, I hear you. I
can't say I disagree. I had Murray win that fight, so.
I did too.
But it is what it is. I mean, there were rumors that Sergio should never have taken that fight. He was still rehabbing the week of. But excuses aside, I think Murray won the fight. So that's just my opinion. And I saw Sergio that wasn't the same Sergio I seen against Paul Williams. It wasn't the same Sergio I seen against Kelly Pavlik. I mean, you could tell from Barker to Macklin to Chavez. I mean, even though he did whoop Chavez's ass for 10, 11 rounds, that he wasn't the same guy. I mean, I don't know. That's just my opinion.
I think he's finished.
I don't know if he's finished. I think that's pretty harsh. Because, I mean, this is his first fight off a major knee surgery.
Yeah, and he's old. Like, old. The surgeries that he's getting, he's supposed to be out 12 to 13, and he's not getting any younger. He's not gonna be standing and trading 12 rounds. But he's finished.
Well, we'll see. He's coming back next year.
All right, Link. We got Sean back on the line. We had to cut him short. Sean, take it away.
Yeah. As I was saying earlier, I mean, it's kind of, you know, out my chest. But you know, I was just.
upset of the fact that they was associating quitters, you know, to Puerto Rican fighters. And I just felt that was very unfair. You understand? Like, I don't care what anybody tell me. Why is it every time a Puerto Rican fighter lose, a big one, everybody makes a big thing. Everybody want to have jokes. Any other ethnicity lose, it's like, well, he lost. You know what I mean? He got his ass whipped, whatever. But when, you see, everybody ripped. Man, we a little speck island, man. We a little piece of island that generates so much talent in more than just boxing. So how can people just try to front on Puerto Rican boxing? Is it in a good place right now? No, it's not. You know, there's a couple of fighters coming up. It happens. Like, that's just what it is right now. But trust me, we'll be back. You know, Rocky Martinez just fought 3 Mexicans in a row, and he did good. You know, maybe we could say the Bugos fight, he might have lost, but it was a tough fight. You know, and he most likely is fighting Salido. You know, that's going to be his 4th Mexican fighter. And he's won. He's won, you know, 2 wins, a draw. You know, his only loss was to Ricky Burns in a real tough fight. I mean, if he had skills like Chelo, he would have destroyed Burns. But, you know, I don't want to make it, you know, the whole thing just about, oh, I just wanted to make the point, how can you associate, you know, quitters, you know, the word quit to Puerto Rican fighters. I mean, that's just retarded. It's stupid. You know, for that, everybody is quitters. Mexicans, blacks, whites, Europeans, everybody's quitters. Because they all quit. You understand? Who, you know, oh, Cotto. Come on, man. Cotto, yeah, Margarito beat him to a pulp, but he beat him in the rematch. So if Cotto was so damaged and Margarito took his soul and Margarito damaged him psychologically, why did he take a rematch for? And he won every single round. And why Margarito didn't have the same effect in the first fight? That had nothing to do with his eye. His punches got nothing to do with his eye. You know what I'm saying? That doesn't raise something. Wow. In fact, every fight since after the first Cotto fight, Margarito got destroyed in every fight, but his first fight back after his suspension when he fought a Taco Bell supervisor in Mexico. And he went 12 rounds with that dude. I forgot his name. So, you know, it is what it is. But
his name, you know, is Roberto Garcia.
Yeah.
You no, just said something right now? His
name is
Roberto
Garcia. Juan Manuel Garcia, you said?
No, Roberto. Roberto Garcia. They fought in Mexico.
Oh, Roberto. Oh, Roberto Garcia. The guy he fought. Yeah.
Yes, yeah, same Roberto Garcia. But people defend
a cheater. It's ridiculous, but I mean, it is what it is. But I heard before when I just got on, I'm hearing about someone call in talking about that Sergio Martinez, he feels he's finished. I mean, Sergio's not finished. Is he the same fighter? Is he losing steam? You know, it seems like every fight. Yes, he is. But let's take into account his last opponent wasn't a bum fighter. I mean, Martin Murray arguably beat Felix Sturm in Germany and got a draw. Many people felt he beat Sergio. I felt Sergio won the fight. But you can't argue. If people felt he won that fight, you can't really say, oh, you bugging. It was a close fight. So, you know, kind of a fight that could have gone either way. But it's still a tough, you know, European fighter. I know Nez kind of coined the phrase Euro bums. But these guys, you know, Barker, Macklin, Martin Murray, these guys are not bums, man. They tough, quality opponents. Will they ever be elite fighters in the game? I doubt it. But they tough. They're not going to be an easy out for nobody. And Martin Murray's going to give Chavez Jr. all he can handle. And who knows? He might get robbed out there. So we'll see, man. But I think Sergio needs to really, really rehab, come back 100%, and I think he has one more magical fight in him. And if that, and if he does, it has, I want him to do that against Triple G. And so, you know, we could get a, you know, a unanimous number one at, well, we already know, no, I mean, Sergio is the number one at 160. That's not even an argument. But, you know, everybody's yelling Triple G now. So I want my man Sergio to get a shaking with him already.
Sean, speaking of Murray Chavez taking place in Mexico, does Murray get a fair shake? And if he doesn't, this will be three straight fights fought on enemy territory where he doesn't get the fair shake. And before you answer that, let's get Pluck on the line. Pluck, what's going on, brother? Kinfolk. Kinfolk. You're out of here. Sean, go ahead and answer that question.
Yeah, you know, Ness, it's the problem with boxing is that, you know, about getting fair decisions in someone's home country. And it sucks for Murray. You know, he's, in order for him to fight these fighters, he has to travel to, you know, enemy territory. And we know how it is. I mean, it's hard, especially someone like, no way, Chavez Jr., I mean, a son of a legend. If you're not knocking him out in Mexico, you're not going to beat him. You're not. I mean, Murray has to clearly, I mean, when I say clearly, I mean clearly win 10 rounds just to get a 7-5, 7-5 rounds, you know, in that fight. It's going to be, you thought Argentina, you know, many people felt was bad. Mexico's going to be worse. You know, especially Chavez Jr. is coming off the suspension. You know, there's you know, anticipation of Chavez Jr. possibly, you know, fighting Triple G at 160. He even mentioned he's willing to go up to 168 and fight Ward. He's willing to do that. Or after seeing Sergio's performance with Martin Murray in his last fight, he's going to say, yo, I wouldn't mind a rematch, and I wouldn't blame him. You know, so, I mean, it's going to suck, man. You hate to see fighters like Martin Murray, you know, blue-collar kind of fighters, you know, humble, just come and do their job. And, you know, they work their tails off, man, and these fucking judges, you know, end up screwing them over.
I hear you, man. Vic, you got anything? Vic?
Ness, I want to ask you. I didn't get to hear the Walmart interview, but what did Walmart say about him making 126? And I'm say,
Sean, you there?
Yeah.
I kind of heard you a little bit. You got cut off. You said, what did he say?
What did he say about him making 126? Because I don't think Walmart, well, he cannot make that weight, man.
What he said was that they're at 139 right now, and they're two months out, and they're just going to take it really relaxed, and they'll get there. They did try to get Angel Heredia and Alex Ariza, but those guys are tied up with bigger name fighters right now, and they couldn't get him. But 209, you're live on the Boxing Voice. Who's this? Sean, can you mute yourself for one moment?
Hold on. I just want to jump in on what Sean says. Aside from what Chelo did, and aside from maybe what Cal Duran.
You're live. Who's this?
Go ahead. My bad.
This is the Filipino.
All right, Filipino, what's up?
You hear me?
It's Pacquiao?
You hear me?
Yeah, we hear you.
Okay. That's good. What is this?
This is a boxing radio show. You want to talk about Manny Pacquiao?
Oh, Manny Pacquiao, very good. Very good.
Oh, man, you do a good Filipino impersonation, brother.
Oh, I'm very Filipino. That's not an impersonation.
I hear you, man.
Hey, besides Manny Pacquiao, who's your favorite fighter?
Donito Donaire getting his ass beat.
Oh, that's very improvisational from your in your side.
Why? Because Rigondeaux beat his ass?
I don't want to call this show now because that's very offensive because that is a Filipino fighter.
Yeah, but he lost.
Oh, because Rigondeaux is a very good boxer.
Now he's a good boxer all of a sudden? Before, Filipinos used to say that Rigondeaux had to get more fights and he was untested. They even called them monkeys. That. Hello? You still there?
I am very here, Steve.
Yo, so do you know the Pac-Man song?
Which one? He has a many.
The one that he sang on HBO.
No, I don't know that song. You know it?
Okay, which song you know?
We can sing it together.
Which song you know?
I know there's a lot. There's many. The one he likes to sing in English?
Yeah, sing it, man. Sing it.
Oh, I don't know how to sing.
Which song you know? Turn your radio down, Franklin. All right, well, Pac-Man, we're going to go ahead and let you go. We got other callers on unless you got something to say about boxing, baby.
Okay, thank you for letting me in. Manny Pacquiao, he is going to beat Brandon Rios. No problem.
By knockout or by decision?
Oh, let's see. By headbutt.
All right, man. You have a good night. Thanks for tuning in.
Oh, thank you.
All right, brother. I have no clue if that was a real Filipino, but if it wasn't, he does a hell of an impersonation. Franklin, you're live. What's going on, brother?
What's up? What's good, man? Hey, I just wanted to make a comment.
Chilling, man. You know, talking boxing.
About Martinez should probably retire. Well, if Martinez should retire and he beat the crap out of Chavez Jr. and fought a close fight with Murray, shouldn't they retire then since they can't beat an old man? Or what you
great
think about
point.
That?
Great point.
Or is it that we expect...
No, I think it's a great point.
Or is it that he is in such a high level that we expect more out of him like we do people like Floyd Mayweather? That when they slip a little bit, I think we're just expecting too much from Martinez. But everybody's going to have their ups and downs, you know? It's boxing.
Yeah, I agree with you, man. I don't think that Martinez should hang it up. I actually think that he will make a great fight with Peter Quillen, and he'll probably win an easy decision versus Gil.
Yeah, I think so also. Oh, and another thing. You're a Broner fan, right?
You know it.
Okay. But, I mean, you have Broner on your top 10 pound for pound?
I don't do pound for pound, man. Those things are subjective. Those are opinionative. Look, if you could fight, you could fight. I'm not putting you up there in a list with a dude that weighs 168, another one that weighs 160, another one that weighs 147. Because then we have to, first of all, hypothetically assume if all these fighters were in the same weight, how would they perform versus one another? And we just don't know if they're going to lose certain qualities that we see in them at different weights. So I don't really do pound for pound. I just say that Broner at 135 can beat everybody. And I see him at 140 doing a lot of damage, but probably not beating everybody.
You don't think Gamboa would be too quick for Broner?
I think that Gamboa would get knocked out. We've seen him be dropped by miscellaneous fighters, no-frills fighters, Michael Farinas of the world. He's fought over in Germany and's got dropped. What makes you think he's not going to get dropped or Stone Cold Steve Austin by a guy who's already beaten the shit out of mostly everybody he gets in the ring with?
Yeah, but you know, Broner fights flatfoot in the stationary, and he had problems with Ponce. And Gamboa had no problems with Ponce de Leon. I think he'll be too quick for Broner. Too much movement.
I think that that's I think that that's completely incorrect. I think Gamboa did have problems with Ponce. If you don't remember, he hit him behind the head. There was a clash of heads. All those things mean that there was problems. I was live at that fight. Yeah. That wasn't even Gamboa's best-looking fight. He had problems with Ponce, and he had problems with Salido. He won those fights, but he didn't look as great as he has in past fights.
Okay, is Broner winning fight? My bad. Is Broner winning fights because of skills, or is Broner winning fights because of his size? Is he just walking down smaller guys?
All right, but the same could be said about Gamboa. He's never even fought at 135 for you to assume he's going to take this weight any better.
Robert.
Yeah, 208. Just hold on, 208. Hold on, 208. We're still on with someone else.
We've never seen him
fight at 135.
But one of Gamboa's interviews, he said he came up to 135 so he could catch Broner. Broner moved up. And when they asked Broner about fighting Gamboa, because 50 Cent and Gamboa always talk about fighting Broner, all he says is Gamboa who? So when somebody mentions, act like they don't know somebody, they see him as a threat, usually.
Franklin, I have to question how long you've been a boxing fan.
Why is that?
I just want to know.
No, I'm talking about because of his movement. I think he fights too stationary, Broner. I think he'd have too much problem with his movement. I think Gamboa would just stick him in and move.
That's fine, but how long have you been watching the sport of boxing?
Years, long time. Probably about 15, 20.
All right. Now, you've seen Gamboa get dropped by Michael Furanus.
The same with Regal. Regal gets dropped. Trinidad always got dropped. Some people just get dropped. But they, when you get up and win, that's what counts. I'd rather have a fighter that knows how to get dropped.
I don't think Gamboa's ever been hit by anybody with the power or has even fought anybody with the agility or skill of a Broner. And I'm not saying Broner's this elite-level fighter, but we can see his boxing ability. That uppercut
I'm not saying Broner's
serious.
Bad. I just think he'll have problems with the faster guy.
But Gamboa would be the smaller guy as well.
That's true. Reese was the smaller guy. Reese was tagging. He was tagging him for a while. The only problem was Reese was too small and that power. You know, once he started walking Reese down, it was over for Reese. So, but I think if Reese would have been a little stronger, a little faster, you know. I like Broner, though. I just think he's overhyped.
I hear you, man. I got another caller here. I do want to thank you for calling in. You still there, Franklin? Franklin, you there? Billy, you there?
Yes, I am. How you doing, man?
I'm doing great. Give me one moment. Hey, Franklin, if you're still listening, I apologize. I don't know what happened. I don't want you to think that I hung up on you because you're picking Gamboa to beat Broner. That's definitely not my style. So if you want, call back in. We're live with Bad Billy from the Octagon. Billy, what's going on, brother?
Not much. I got ringside Robert on my three-way with me, and I believe there's a couple of things he wanted to say.
I left you a voicemail, Nestor, after Thursday's show. So, and you're talking about Gamboa and Adrian Broner. Is that what I just heard?
Well, that is something that a caller brought up. But yeah, if you want to talk about
I think that would be a total mismatch. I think Adrian Broner would tear him apart.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, why is that?
Gamboa does not have the quickness or the speed to keep up with Adrian Broner in the speed department or the punching because Gamboa to me is a stationary fighter, and I think Adrian would have a field day with him. I think somebody like Pauly is going to give Adrian more trouble because Pauly is going to be able to move around the ring a lot like Adrian does himself, and I don't think Gamboa can do that.
Well, Robert, first thing I'll say is great minds think alike. And I agree with you 100%. I don't know if my co-host Victor Salazar feels any different, but I think the Gamboa-Adrian Broner might end up being a mismatch.
It's a huge mismatch.
I think Broner's too big, too strong.
I see that as a total mismatch.
That's an easy win for Broner, in my opinion. Gamboa doesn't have the chin to hang. It's that simple. It's that simple.
No, that hurt. So, that has early knockout written all over. Robbie?
Yeah, I agree. But you got anything else for us before we move on to the next caller? And I just found your voicemail. I will play that as soon as you hang up.
Okay, Billy, did you have something for him?
Absolutely. Ness, it's good to talk to you here on the show. And as you know, as I posted it on Twitter and forwarded you the pictures, I'm going to be having two live interviews coming up, one on May 30th, actually, and the other one on the 6th of June with current IBO welterweight champion Chris Van Heerden and out of South Africa, and then the following week I'll be interviewing Hector El Curicon Munoz out of New Mexico. And when it comes time for those interviews, I'd like to invite you and anyone else you'd like to bring along if you'd like to join me for those interviews.
Yeah, definitely. We'll talk details after off air, and I did retweet that. And I look forward to hearing from Chris, man, because he's definitely in the top 10 in that 140-pound division or welterweight division. What is he, Vic, welterweight or junior welterweight? I know he's one of the two, but we haven't seen much of him over here, so it'll be interesting to hear him and get his thoughts on when he's coming over to the U.S. Because, like I always say, this is not only the land of the opportunity, but this is the land of the visibility in terms of a fighter getting noticed.
I agree with that 100% for sure.
Well, these are two interviews that we're looking forward to doing. I'll also be a part of both of those. So we thought we would invite you and Vic and or whoever else you wanted to bring along to add to the show here, because you guys do a wonderful job.
Man, we appreciate the invitation, and we'll definitely take you up on that offer. Like I said, we'll discuss details off air. I'm getting a few calls, guys, so I got to go ahead and let you go. Thanks for calling. Robbie, I'm going to play your voicemail right now, so stay tuned in.
All right.
All right. Thanks.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
All right. I just had his voicemail pulled up. Vic. Oh, okay, here it goes. See what Robbie had to tell us.
Hello, Ness and Vic. This is Ringside Robert from California. I listened to Thursday's Boxing Voice. I just finished it a little bit ago, and I got several comments. I don't have the internet, so I listen to it through the MyTelespace phone system. I work on a podcast covering boxing myself.
That voicemail got paused. We got a new caller. 470, you're live on the Boxing Voice. What's going on?
What's going on? It's Big Trav.
Big Trav from YouTube, what's good?
Not much, man. I don't know really what y'all talking about too much, but to give you an opportunity to ask me any questions.
Talking whatever you want to talk about, brother.
I heard you was talking about a little bit about Sergio Martinez and Adrian Broner, kind of, you know, that kind of got my attention a little bit. You know, that fight coming up.
Well, actually, those were the callers. Those were the callers. One caller called in saying that Gamboa would beat Broner. Another caller called in saying that Broner would dismantle Gamboa. Me and Vic agree. And a voicemail and a few callers said that Sergio needs to retire. Others feel that that was just one bad fight. But what's your thoughts on either subject?
Well, as a long-time boxing fan, I've gotten to find out with some of these fighters, man, you just never know what to expect from them. I mean, with Gamboa, he looks good sometimes, and sometimes he don't look good. Sometimes he gets dropped. But for some reason, he's always able to get back up and find a way to win. There is a size difference there. I think maybe at the same size, if both guys were the same size, it would probably be an easier, you know, guess on who would win. I think Gamboa has always found a way to win, but it's just, I don't know. You never know what to spit out of that guy. I would probably have to get at the bronze just because of the size and power. But, I mean, I just, you know, I'm a big skeptic on Broner. I think the guy's got skills, but, you know, we haven't seen him fight anyone, and I think picking Polymal and Najee, that's going to be an easy fight. I'm just going to say it. It's going to be an easy fight, and I'm going to say it. And I think people out there, they've always given Mal and Najee too much credit in certain departments. I mean, his skills are good. He's got good movement, but he's a one-handed fighter. Let's face it. You can't do shit with one hand. You can't do shit with a jab, especially if you don't have power. You know, he's not Vladimir Klitschko who can beat you with a jab. I mean, there's nothing he's going to be able to do. Now, that being said, you got to get a fight at Broner. I mean, otherwise, if he had a good right hand, if he was two-handed fighter, I would say he would smoke Broner because he's a good boxer. I mean, he gets hit a little bit more, you know, than he should, but I think his chin is really good. So I think Malinagi's been in there with Cotto. He's been there with a lot of guys, and he's never been knocked out. So I think he's got a good chance. So if he was two-handed fighter and he had decent pop, I'd say he smoked Broner. But with one hand, I don't see how you beat anybody with one hand. So as far as Martinez, you know, they let him heal up. You know, the guy heals up. You know, one more, you know, hoorah, or maybe you just see how he fights, and if he does good, I think what Martinez just needs to do is make some adjustments in his game because he's relied on certain things, you know, to get him through these fights, and he's got to make some adjustments, and maybe, I mean, I know it's hard to tell a fighter to change, especially when they're older, but he's got to figure out what he's going to do on the inside because I think that's the main thing. That's when Martinez gets hit is when they're clinching on the inside a lot. So maybe, you know, I don't know, learn some new tricks, man. You can't teach an old dog new tricks, but he's going to have to because he's falling apart. I mean, his hand is hurting and stuff like that and all that kind of stuff. So,
What can you teach Martinez, though?
You know, when his physical skills were going, he had to learn how to do some, you know, he had to add more dimension to the game. So if he's going, my opinion is if he's going, you know, keep fighting and, you know, maybe, you know, make some adjustments in his style so that he can, you know, be able to fight some of these bigger guys that he's fighting, you know, at 160 pounds or maybe it might just be good for him to move back to 154. And campaign there, that might be even a better idea. Heal up and go back to 154. Maybe, you know, fight Canelo or Floyd or something. I don't know.
I just don't know if Sergio could get back down.
I don't think he can get back down to 154. And I don't think you can teach him anything.
Trav, we're going to go ahead and let you go. Thanks for the call, right, brother. Thanks for being a listener.
All right, guys, watch me on Real Talk Boxing. Check me out on YouTube, Real Talk Boxing and MMA. So sorry about the last part, MMA, but.
Yeah, I was about to curse you out for saying MMA. But, nah, we should have a Lamont Peterson and Lucas Matisse glove signed on Tuesday, and we'll be talking about it Thursday for a giveaway. So stay tuned then. Spread the word. And thank you for being a caller and a listener of the show. I wanna Vic, talk a little bit. Let me look for the winners because I only got two winners that reached out to me for the glove. I need the other two so I can get their addresses, man, and ship these gloves out. Okay, so the winners for the gloves, even though Vic didn't talk, so we won't have no dead air. He's too busy over there eating arroz con gandules.
You told me to search for the winners, and that's what I was looking for. I don't see it.
B underscore King, 29. Matty Fresh, we already know you won. Vic or myself will be taking the glove down to AC for you personally. Ben Loki, I'll be shipping yours out tomorrow. And E Foskin. E-F-O-I-S King. So whoever that is. So that's B underscore King 29 and E-F-O-S whatever King. Make sure you reach out to us. We need your address. 646, you're live on a box of voice. The BX, who's this?
Yo, how you doing? This is Joe.
Joe, what's going on, brother?
How you guys doing? This comment is for Vic. Hello?
I'm listening.
Come at his head.
Yeah, what you think about Pacquiao requesting USADA against Rios?
Well, it's not USADA anymore, and I've said it clearly that USADA is a joke of an organization because if you follow the sport, You know what happened with the Morales and Danny Garcia. You know what happened with Peter Quillen and Winky Wright, how to destroy the substances when somebody tests positive and all this other stuff. And you should know that USADA has no jurisdiction in China. But it's not USADA anymore. It's VADA. So maybe Pacquiao is 4 years too late on it. But for those that have been asking for Pacquiao to take the test, he's taking it. And for those that have been asking for a memo already,
like what you think about the hypocrisy? That's what I want to know. Like, what you think about that? Like,
well, here's the thing: when Mayweather and Pacquiao, the whole thing was going down, the organization that was going to be in charge, the only organization that Floyd Mayweather deals with, is USADA. So
it's WADA. He deals with WADA.
It's USADA, my man.
But
there is hypocrisy. I totally understand where you're coming from. But from what we've learned so
far. Break it down for me.
What's up? The hypocrisy.
I don't understand. Where's the hypocrisy? Break it down.
Well, the hypocrisy is Pacquiao now is accepting drug testing. Whether it was USADA, VADA, whatever. He's taking drug testing.
I could have sworn you guys were saying that Mayweather the fraud. He's asking for something. He never asked for nobody else. Etc.
Well, he didn't.
Your opinion on why now, 4 years later, he's taking the same test that he didn't take 4 years ago.
Well, it's not the same test. It's not the same.
He's taking VADA now. Let's say he is taking VADA now.
Well, that's what he's doing. That's what he's doing.
Why he took so long to finally take a random test?
You know why? You know why? He got knocked the fuck out by someone under suspicion. And he's fighting a fighter.
No, but
he's fighting a fighter that has the same strength and conditioning coach next.
And those are two great points, Vic, that I wasn't even going to mention. I was going to go this route. Maybe Pacquiao feels like he's on his way out. He wants to get a good win over Rios and then go back to the negotiating table with Mayweather. Proven and showing that he's willing to take the test.
No, you're not understanding. He took too long. It's funny because sometimes I go back and I look at the old interviews and I see the bullshit excuses on why they don't want to take a test. He feels weak. Who is Mayweather to dictate the terms? Freddie Roach, he had an interview with the man on Fight Hub TV. I don't know if you guys are familiar with the fight or not, but he's telling the guy, if you don't, they were talking about Pacquiao taking the test against Marquez in the fifth fight, and Freddie Roach was like, if Marquez don't take the Olympic-style drug test the next fight, he must be hot or something. You know what I'm saying? But the media never calls him out on it. You know what I'm saying? Total hypocrisy. I had to bring it up. You know what I'm saying? And if y'all continue to protect him, it is what it is. But come on, let's just be honest. You know?
But I'm not protecting him. I'm not protecting him.
You're not protecting anybody.
I see the hypocrisy, and I see where you're coming from. But I'm telling you why I think he's doing it now, because he just got knocked out.
I know why he's doing it. And it's just my opinion. He got knocked out. Now he feels like it's important to do it, but it took him getting knocked out in that particular fashion to do the test, and I think that's ridiculous. You know what I'm saying?
No, I agree.
Yeah, but Joe.
No, but I agree, because it took him for someone to do to him what he's been doing to other people. Is that not what we're talking about, right? Because he did it to Cotto, he did it to Hatton, he did it to Margarito, he did it to whoever, De La Hoya.
It's not even just that. His excuses for not taking it and just getting whole weight. It did not hold weight at all. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's like I'm working somewhere and I tell my boss is like, you know what? We don't want to take urine no more. We want you to do a blood test because of this, that, and the third. And I tell him, needles make me weak. He's more likely going to fire me just because, like, he knows that's bullshit. You know what I'm saying? Y'all agree?
I agree, but Joe, this is what I'm saying. Isn't it better late than never? And for you to say it's too late, you got to remember,
he should still take the test. I condemn him for doing it. But I'm saying, I think it's a great idea he's still doing it. Like you said, it's better than him never taking it. But I got to call him out on the hypocrisy. I got to. You know what I'm saying? The media, everybody blamed Mayweather all because he wanted to fight this guy on the even playing field. Like, you know what I'm saying? And now he waited 4 years later until he got knocked out to take the same test. I don't care if it's violent. It's still random. It's not like he's taking a key test where they could just, they let you know exactly when they taking this pee. They not taking this blood. You know what I'm saying? And we all know blood detects more things. Like, you got to take the blood. So.
But my Hello? Point is this, Joan, we're going to let you go. We're getting another call. There's only two guys doing million plus pay-per-views, and that's Pacquiao Mayweather. If Pacquiao can put away one of the reasons why this fight could never get made and start to take Olympic-style drug testing, we're one step closer to getting that fight. Whether it's too late and it's not the same Pacquiao, Floyd and Pacquiao will still make millions of dollars. People will still buy it. But thanks for calling in. You can always call in. And Thursday, we'll be giving away a Lamont Peterson Lucas Matisse glove, so make sure you tell a friend and tell a friend. 776, you're live, and you got a lot of background noise, brother. What's going on? No, 774.
Hey, what's up? I'm Efo is King. I don't know how I get you my information, though.
Okay, are you on Twitter?
Yep, I'm at Efo is King. Yep.
All right. So DM me.
I can't.
DM me on Twitter
me.
So I can get your address.
I can't because you're not following me.
At me and I will follow you.
Okay. Cool. Thank you. Cheers, guys.
That was Efo is King. Efo is King. I get it now.
I thought it meant Ephraim for president. Ephraim for king.
Lex Ruger.
Lex. What up?
What's going on, man?
What up?
Chilling.
What's up with this dude just calling in just for that glove and shit and hanging up?
Call him out, man.
For real, what the fuck, man?
It's Ephraim for King. I think that was his Twitter name, Ephraim for King. I know we have Ephraim for president. Now we got a new dude.
What y'all talking about, Ruga, man?
I want to know, you calling him out for just calling for the glove, I'm going to call you out. I ain't see no Lex Ruger fucking review on iTunes.
Man, you got to fucking put in a damn credit card number, man. Fuck that shit.
Nah, but dog, that's iTunes. It doesn't matter. They're not going to charge you. That's in case you ever want to buy a song or something.
I'm straight.
Yo, Lex don't want to be on any grid right now. He don't want to be no grid.
Don't put me on no trails, son.
I don't know. Next is Cash Money. Lex is Cash Money, man. That's all he does.
Yo, he think he Jason Bourne right now.
Hey, what's up with Burns though, man? That bum ass nigga, man.
Yo. I'm surprised Ness ain't going harder on him then. He proved it to you yesterday.
Man.
Damn. Ness, you went harder on Provotnikov than Ricky Burns. Let's be real. Hey, Lex. Ruslan Provotnikov took Tim Riley to hell and back. Ness destroyed him.
Somebody got none left inside, huh?
Exactly. Ricky Burns was out of the box for 9 rounds and escaped with a victory. And he's getting a pass.
Maybe you're right. Maybe I ain't got it no more.
All right, then don't you waste my time no more. You hear that? Go back to
Lex. Lex, I think Ness got a heart all of a sudden.
A two-bit nothing. But don't you ever come back here again, because I'm too old to waste my time trying to train a no-good loser like you. You bum!
God, that's for Ricky Burns. That's how hard I could go on him right there, dog.
I mean, you shitted on Provotnikov, man.
It is, man. I've been saying it.
But you destroyed Ruslan.
Oh my God! You should have heard him after the fucking win.
Nah, them commentators was
man.
Off the fucking hook, man.
Damn, that shit was horrible,
commentators,
man.
And people call me biased.
Yo, they were talking about that
them
he took
dudes,
Gonzalez's
man, they
heart.
Out of control.
He took his heart. Some shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, what the fuck? This dude just gave up. You know what I'm saying? Man. Not that he took his heart. He fucking hurt his wrist. Whatever the fuck he did. You know what I'm saying? Even though dude shouldn't have quit.
He shouldn't have quit.
He could have kept going, but still, man. That dude did not snatch
his
heart.
9 minutes and he
could have
been
saying.
A world champion.
Yeah, man. They made that dude seem
Ruga,
like he was
hold
fucking
on. Don't hang
Floyd
up. 561. 561, you're live real quick, because if we don't get to you, Ruger will talk forever. Go for it.
Yeah, I just got two questions. One about the Matisse Peterson fight, one about Mayweather's boxing style. The one with the Matisse Peterson fight, my opinion, or kind of how I see the fight, is either Peterson's gonna, try to, push him and keep it on the inside and fight on the inside, or Matisse is gonna try to use the power and maybe catch him, sometime during the fight. So it's kind of 50-50 how the fight gonna go. Just want to see what what's your opinion on how the fight's going to play out?
Vic, you want to go ahead and get that first?
I don't know what to expect, man. I don't know what to expect in this fight. I'm not going to lie to you. This is honestly, man, when it comes
– mad gay on this fight.
When it comes to Thursday, I may pick a draw, man.
Thursday show to make a pick?
I might pick a draw, man. I don't know who to pick right now.
So you wait until Thursday to make a pick?
Absolutely. I'm waiting until we get video on both these dudes.
Yeah, I'm not asking for a pick. I'm just asking how you think the fight is going to play out and what are the strong points for each fighter.
I'll tell you this. Lamont is a guy that doesn't waste energy on stupid things. He doesn't bounce in the ring. He doesn't waste his energy on doing something that's not going to be beneficial to him. He's a good inside fighter. We've seen that. But does he want to make it an inside fight with Lucas Matisse? Does he want to bang with Lucas Matisse? Is he afraid of that power? Does he even think Lucas has power? I mean, we've seen Lucas's power knock down guys, but not put him to sleep. So, what's that stupid saying? It's an immovable object against us, whatever that bullshit is. That's what it is, man.
Vic,
I don't know, man. I can't pick this fight.
Hey, but what about this? What if he does want to make it an inside fight? So many people talking about this whack-ass power that Matisse got.
But why is it whack? He took it down
to smother the power. What if he goes in and fight an inside fight to smother the power? If you can't extend your punches, you can't hit.
Yeah, that's all I kind of see it maybe playing out with Peterson.
But that also means the same with Peterson, though.
You know, a lot of punching on the inside, and maybe, you know.
Dude, he negated almost all of Khan's offense by being in close and being right in his chest.
Yeah, but it wasn't decisive. It wasn't a decisive win. You can't say that.
It was good enough.
I put that performance up with Devin Alexander. It's the same shit. I couldn't pick a winner with Judah Matisse. It's just
all right. So caller, what about your second comment?
All right, my second question was about Mayweather's fighting style. I've been watching boxing for a while. I say since I was about 16. You know, but around that time I was just watching it as a tune in to somebody get their ass knocked out. You know, but like these past 3 years I really started paying attention of what the fighter's trying to do and how the fighter's, using his game plan to win the fight. And I noticed a lot with Mayweather, I looked at when he fought Mosley, a little bit of Ortiz, when he fought Guerrero. And I noticed that whenever he goes on the offense, he's always looking at the set of the straight right. Whenever the fighter is trying to, punch him, he always counters with a short left hook or a left hook.
Left hook.
Yeah, and then whenever they get into the inside, he likes to hold with his left arm, the other guy's arm. With his right hand, he likes to set up the uppercut, to try to sneak in, straight right. So I've been noticing that, for a long time, like he always does the same things over and over. You know, and I never boxed before, but like a real good trainer. I know they got to be seeing that. So they're training their fighter to win. Why can't they come up with a game plan? He's going to do the same thing over and over. And I don't understand how.
Why you can't come up with a game plan? Because he's just so diverse. He gives you a round or two to figure you out. And once he figures you out, it's over. I mean, I don't know. You got to be so diverse to be Mayweather. You got to be on that skill. I mean, Miguel Cotto is a Hall of Famer in some eyes. Miguel Cotto gave him a good fight, but after rounds 6, 7, and 8, Floyd had him figured out. It took him 3 rounds to figure out Guerrero.
Yeah, it kind of seemed like to me Cotto kind of went off the game plan on those rounds that he should have kept, pressure onto the ropes, working the body a little bit, come up on top, I think like Ricky Hand kind of had the same kind of game plan. Maybe Dylan De La Hoya, I'm not sure. I didn't, really go over that fight too good. They want to try to pressure him, I don't know, I guess try to win a decision like that or try to wear him down. I don't know. That's why I thought Guerrero had a pretty good chance. He's a young guy, he's got a chin. He's going to put a lot of pressure on him, and he's a southpaw, so, he's got to change up, his game plan. It's kind of like Mayweather started using his left jab a lot more. I guess he does that more against southpaw fighters. But Guerrero couldn't, implement his game plan, the same game plan that everybody's been trying to do is to pressure him, try to break him down.
I don't know. It's tough. It's a Rubik's Cube that only one man has been close to solving, and that was Jose Luis Castillo. Many people had him winning that fight, but aside from him, I don't know.
Yeah, okay, all right.
All right, caller. Well, thanks for the call.
Thanks for your opinion. I just want to give my pick. I think Matisse is going to catch him and not get him out. Keep care on him. But yeah, I'll call right Thursday.
Well, you make sure you call in Sunday night.
Yeah, all right. Yeah,
what's your name?
I'll call in Sunday night and, see what you got to say if Matisse wins.
Yeah, no problem. But what's your name?
I'm Juan. My name is Juan from Belgrade, Florida.
All right, Juan, because I'm writing everybody down who's picking Matisse so I can laugh at him come Sunday night. I'm just saying.
All right.
But we're going to let you go. We got another caller. 682, you're live on the Boxing Voice. Who's this?
It's the president, bitch.
Ephraim.
Oh, Ephraim, what's up?
Y'all ain't catched my inauguration?
Wait, Ephraim, this is not you on Twitter, right?
What?
Is that you? EFO is king?
Hell no.
Oh, alright.
Alright, well, I don't know what's up with all these, well, I didn't see no Lamont Peterson fans. I mean, they ain't gonna be none soon either. Anyway, I mean, the dude already looks the part of a bum with that big ass scruffy beard. I mean, Matisse is my boy. The machine Matisse is, I should say. Gonna run right through his ass. And let me tell y'all something. Game plan? Yo, game plan. Matisse doesn't have a game plan. Lamont Peterson can't follow a game plan. We saw him get tagged up by Kendall Holt, which is a better boxer than him. But these dudes don't bring game plans to a fight, man. They don't. They don't know what a game plan is. They are not round winners. They just bang it out. And that's what we're going to see. We're going to see two fucking Brandon Rios's in the
Ephraim, I think that's where you're wrong. I think, what? Vic, you would agree with me that Lamont Peterson does have the ability to box and has showed us that in the past. When he got dropped by Bradley, he was boxing. I think it was after that drop, right?
Yeah, I can see. So, I see what you're saying.
So you say to for Lamont Peterson, avoid a slug match, he should box. He's the one with the ability to box. He resorts to boxing. Is that what you're saying?
No. I'm saying, if you want to know what I think the game plan is, I think the game plan is to smother Matisse. Get in close.
Good luck.
Don't
with
let
that.
His overhand right even be successful because Peterson is too dead in his chest.
Yeah, Pearson knows what to do with that, but, you know, he's a late starter. Look how long it took for him to be at the con. Look how long it took to do that to a fucking Holt. I mean, he starts late, and how did he get with Ortiz? I mean,
what you mean, how long? Yo, Ephraim.
What's up?
Dude, after the third round or the second round, he was putting the fucking paws on Holt.
Yeah, but he got it already. That's two fucking rounds. Lucas knocked my nigga Dallas out in one round.
And who has Dallas beat?
All right, how many first round
knockouts?
You're
talking about a dude that's not on the same level, man.
How many first round knockouts does Peterson have? Boxtrek, Vic, what's up with that?
Yo, so how many first round knockouts does Matisse have over people you even fucking know?
It don't matter. I need to get you done.
Oh, it don't matter? It don't matter? Yeah. Come on, man. That's like you knocking out fucking 10 bums off the street, walking out the liquor store after buying a 40-ounce with fucking 400 pennies.
Well, that's
you don't get no
thing,
credit
we
for that.
We're going to see Saturday. We're going to see. That's a beautiful thing. And just remember,
that's right.
Just remember the team machine Matisse told your ass so. And there's a lot of room on the bandwagon out here, my man.
All right, and just remember, when I say...
Now, when I say, who's the master, you say, show
ya. Yeah, that reference probably...
You hear me? So when I say, who's the master at picking winners, you say, Ness GTO. You got it?
Man, all right, let's move away from the obvious of Matisse's winning. What else? What's the other fight? That was on the table y'all talking about?
Devin Alexander versus Lee Purdy.
Who the fuck is Lee Purdy?
the dude Devin Alexander gets to make free money off of.
All right, all right. Oh, so I want to talk about the two next possible Mayweather opponents, which I think is Amir Khan or Devin. Because I think you know the beautiful thing about Mayweather not fighting Canelo, Canelo brings a lot of fans. Yes, they can be Cinnabons, which means, you know, they only know Canelo exists in the boxing world. But it opens their eyes. It opens their eyes. Yeah, you know what? Mayweather doesn't want to fight Canelo. And then all the boxers will say, that's that shit I'm talking about, that he's a fucking ducker. And millions of Canelo fans will open their eyes and say, you know what? This black motherfucker has been ducking everybody. And that's, I mean, then one day a pay-per-view goes head-to-head or something, which will never happen. I think Canelo has more fans. I think trying to...
Efren, hold on. Yeah. Hold on, Efren. I got another call. Hold on. Unknown caller. I hope it's Liam. Who's this?
Nah, it's Lewis. MB2. What's up?
Who?
It's Lewis, man. Calling from Scotland.
What's going on, brother?
Yeah, I'm just a quick call, man. I don't know what you said about Ricky Burns. What did you say? What did you think about the fight?
I thought that he got damn lucky that Gonzalez quit. At the time of the stoppage, I had it 7-2. And I think he should be happy that Broner moved up, because Broner would have put him in his coffin.
I was there. I was at the fight. And after the 7th round, the 8th round and the 9th round was all Burns. So you can't say it was luck. You know?
What do you mean you can't say it was luck? The man would have, even if he would have won the last 3 rounds, it was 7-5, dude. Ricky Burns lost that fight. He got exposed.
It was on course to stop him. Now listen, that was the worst Ricky Burns performance I've ever seen.
You're not even serious.
No.
Tell us that you're joking right now. You're really calling in to say that a guy with 10 knockouts was on route to stopping somebody?
How he stopped Kevin Mitchell. Kevin Mitchell.
Another Euro level fighter. Come on, man.
Hey, listen. He was breathing out his backside. He had no stamina left. He tried to stop Ricky Burns in the 7th round. He was up until the 7th. He was. But after the 7th, you know, he blew his load. And then it was all Ricky Burns. You know, Ricky Burns conditions himself well. He's got a good chin. Got good stamina. You know, he's not... Listen, his style is not the best. He's too tall. He's too upright. He's got that European style. Up against Broner. Broner will kill Burns. I'll say it. Broner will destroy Burns.
Look, that's it. You made a friend for life with me, because you were telling the truth, Ellis. You know that he stands no chance versus Broner, and that's a fight that a lot of other European fans seem to want to say that Broner somehow ducked Burns and he shouldn't have moved up without fighting Burns. But at least you're coming on telling the truth.
Let me just say before I go, I know you guys are busy and you guys got a lot of calls. Let me just say this about Broner. I don't think his chin is that good. I think his chin isn't there. I think he was backing off against Ponce de Leon, whatever the fuck his name is. And he's not faced a puncher. And as soon as he does, you know, you've heard the story. You're the one who started the rumor about him getting knocked out by, what was his name? Smart.
What do you mean I started the rumor? I ain't started the rumor.
you did, man. I've seen the YouTube videos. You're the one who's interviewing Barry Hunter. And
I'm just trying to get a confirmation, brother. I didn't start the rumor.
You know, now listen, man. On the back of that interview, that was on Boxing Scene. That was on Eastside Boxing Forums. That interview, you know, it wasn't just Barry Hunter. There was another trainer you interviewed, and then he confirmed it.
Yeah, that was Eric Brown.
Actually, that's my name. Yeah, that's my next question. What did you think of that? Eric Brown and Barry Hunter said that they confirmed it. They confirmed what happened. And then at Paulie Malignaggi conference, they said it never happened. What's going on? You know, the Paulie Malignaggi press conference. You know.
Well, look, man. This is what I'll tell you. Paulie Malignaggi says that someone offered to sell him a video of the knockout. Broner, in an interview with myself, when defending Floyd Mayweather for having a black eye, said, what happens in the gym stays in the gym. And he also went on to say, oh, we train hard in the gym. That's why we make it look easy in the ring. And to me, that's basically making excuses for anything negative that may have happened in training to himself or to any fighter. So he was basically blanketing over the entire subject as to have an alibi for himself. My thing is, yep. I was trying to get to the bottom of it. I didn't start it, but I don't know, man. I feel like it's a strong possibility that it's true. I spoke to what's the kid's name who supposedly knocked him out? It escapes me right
Errol
now. Errol Spence. I spoke to Errol Spence. Errol Spence said it's not true, but that they did spar before he ever turned pro. But he didn't give me details as to what happened.
I saw that, and Errol Spence has got a smile on his face when he said it.
Well, there you go. You know your own answer, but I'm going to let you go, brother. I got some other callers calling in.
No worries. Thank you, man.
So much for calling in. I know that it's late over there on the European side of boxing. You know, Scotland, it's late. So we definitely appreciate you. While I may talk about European fighters, you know, and call them, you know.
You bum!
It is what it is. Until one of those guys prove me wrong, you guys got to make more Carl Frotches, and then I guess I'll get off their case. But I'm pretty sure Devin Alexander is going to prove me right Saturday night. But thanks again for the call, brother. And, continue to listen. Thursday we should be doing a giveaway for a Lucas Matisse the Machine versus Lamont Peterson glove.
Yeah, no, I'll do that, man. I'll try and get that glove.
All right, brother. Ephraim for president, what's going on? Turn that radio down.
I couldn't hear y'all, my man. What are y'all talking about?
Man, you supposed y'all to... When I got you on hold, you got to listen to your radio, brother.
Y'all had somebody talking shit or what?
Nah. Somebody was just defending Burns, but still, you know, said that Broner would beat him. And that's pretty much the truth. You know what I mean? It is what it is.
Yeah, that's fair. But, I mean, you talked about...
Hold on, Ephraim. We got another call, but I'm going to keep you on. Just mute yourself.
All right.
666, you're live on the Boxing Voice. Who's this?
Julian. Julian.
Julian, where are you calling from? Turn your radio down.
Oh, for TJ, for Tijuana.
Tijuana?
Hello? Yeah.
You calling from Tijuana?
What's up, man?
Sweet, my man, sweet. I think you're our first Mexican caller to call in all the way live from Mexico. Hey, do you got your radio on? Can you turn it down?
Yeah, it's my computer. I'm listening to your show right now.
All right, hey, great, brother. What's on your mind? Talk to me, man.
I just called just because I like boxing and just, I'm a subscriber to YouTube to a bunch of boxing channels, and I watch your videos, and I just wanted to, you know, just say what's up and just, just talk random stuff. I think my thesis is going to win, man. I see your theory of Peterson smothering Matisse, but my question is who has smothered Matisse before? You know.
All right, and I got a counter question for you. Who has Matisse fought before? Devin Alexander's a pure boxer.
What's that? What's
Zab
that guy?
Judah's a pure boxer.
That African guy.
Mike Dallas, a Josie?
No, that other guy, a Jose. He was a good fighter.
A Jose is a European level fighter. His box rec. All his fights have been in Europe. And his last fight after the knockout was versus a guy 6-28-2. And not two knockouts, two draws.
Yeah.
And a Josie went a unanimous decision.
What about the when he fought at Ortiz and he was being pressured there and he got knocked down.
That's my point. That's one of my biggest points.
Also with,
he got hit by Victor Ortiz, a bigger fighter. A bigger puncher in my eyes. Victor Ortiz has been in the ring with bigger name fighters and showed power. He knocked Maidana down 3 times. I don't even remember anybody else besides Khan knocking Maidana down. And Maidana only went down from a body shot versus Khan. Who else put Maidana down? And Victor Ortiz did it 3 times. So I love to compare Matisse's power to Victor Ortiz. And if he could take Victor Ortiz's punch and get up off the ground 3 times... Because they only counted 2 knockdowns, but a lot of us feel that the third one was a knockdown as well. He got up off of that floor 3 times and still got a draw. So
yeah,
I like Peterson's
point.
Chances.
But I think the fact that he still got knocked down counts for something, where Matisse might be able to knock him down as well. We'll see.
Yeah, listen, I don't deny that there's going to be some flash knockdowns. Peterson has showed us that. He's been down in the Bradley fight. He went down in the Victor Ortiz fight. And he's been down before. But he gets up. And he wins. And he only lost once, and that's to Bradley, a world-class fighter. He's been in with Bradley, Holt, Victor Ortiz, Victor Cayo. I don't consider Cayo high level, but there were some that did. And when that fight was made, I told everybody, look, he's Dominican, I'm Dominican, but he's a bum. And Peterson proved it. Danny Garcia went 12 rounds with Kendall Holt. Peterson knocked him out.
All right, man. Well, thanks for taking my call, man. My mom's giving me a hard time here because I'm calling long distance. So,
yo, next time, call us on Skype. It's free, brother. Just use your computer to Skype us. The name is The Boxing Voice, THA Boxing Voice, and you could call in for free, brother.
All right, man. All right, I'll keep that in mind. My name is Julian Anaya.
Julian, all right, brother.
All right, brother. Peace.
Cool. Efren, you there?
Yeah.
E, you there?
I was the first Mexican caller.
All right, brother.
Yeah.
I know, all the way from Tijuana, Mexico. I'm loving it, brother. We're getting the word out there. So everybody that's listening, pat yourself on the back. That's exactly what I've been telling you for show after show after show. If you share the show, more people will know, and we'll get more callers like that, man. And, you know, that – we don't make any money from this, so that's what makes me happy. You know what I mean? Hearing that people, I don't know if that dude from the Philippines was really a Filipino. He could have been lying because it sounded like a good impression, but it also sounded real. So a guy calls in from the Philippines. A guy calls in from Scotland. A guy just called in from Tijuana. We loving it, man. We loving it. We got Mike calling in right now. Mike, what's going on, brother?
Nice. How you doing, man?
Man, I'm having a great time. I just got a call away from Tijuana. I'm feeling good.
Yeah, I heard that. That's pretty nuts. I'm calling away from Tijuana. Nice. You see they're calling you the Metabomb on the chat right now?
Excuse me?
You see they made a name up for you? It's the Metabomb. I guess like because you're Dominican. I'm trying to tie bomb with Dominican. That's kind of fun.
That's a good one. Hey, man. It's all good. It's all good. I've been picking winners, though.
Nah, I know.
I want these people to stay on the chat. Let me see. Who's this? Beast Mode. I never heard him call in. Beast Mode, won't you call in and make a pick? Put it on air. Let's go head to head. It's all good, man. Listen, I would be mad if they weren't chatting. As long as they're chatting, it's all good. If I'm the butt end of the joke, it's all good. But guess what? I'll get the last laugh come Saturday and Sunday when we do the show.
Yeah, about that fight, about the Matisse-Peterson fight, it scares me how similar I think with you, because you pick these underdogs, and I'm right with you. I remember calling in a long time ago talking about Rigo and Donaire, and, man, I don't know, you can see that one coming from a mile away. I felt the same way about that one. But as for Saturday, I was really leaning towards Lamont Peterson for weeks now. And the more I'm picturing the fight in my head as we get closer to it, I'm not swaying my pick, but I think it's a toss-up now. And I actually found it very interesting that Vegas has it at the first odds I've seen that came out for it had Lamont Peterson, a 3-1 underdog. I was shocked by that. I mean, really shocked that it was that Matisse was not only the favorite, but a huge favorite in Vegas. How do you think that came about? Why would you think that would be?
Power, man. They're looking at the power. But look, these Vegas guys have been wrong before. Listen, let me tell you about underdog story.
I don't mean because Vegas is always right. I don't mean like that. I mean just because usually Vegas, I'm not gonna try to hide it. I bet on a lot of fights because I'm a boxing maniac like we all are, and we see things before they happen. Because we pay so much attention to it. But usually what I find is that Vegas puts lines out for a fight, not because of based on who they think is going to win in Vegas, but because they want to get that money the way they want it. Or they want somebody to be, they want hard money early on Matisse or hard money early on Peterson. And to have a 3-1 Matisse tells me that they want everybody and their mother betting on Peterson. And that just seems like a crazy, crazy, crazy line to me. I mean, if anything, it's a pick'em fight, in my opinion. I mean, I'm leaning towards Peterson, but if anything, it's a pick'em fight, and I just thought it was really, really odd that so many people poured money in to have, early when that fight came out, to have Peterson a 3-1 underdog. I'm shocked that many people are really feeling good about Matisse. Are we losing us?
Mike, you still there?
Yeah, I'm here. I think I lost you for a minute.
Yeah, you did. But this is my thing. Celestino Caballero versus Jason Litzau. Jason Litzau was like, I think, 21-1 or 16-1. And this kid, he either refinanced or took an equity loan out on his house. Only made $75,000 for the fight, but made $1 million for betting on himself.
Right.
So,
yeah.
Fuck Vegas. And this fight, you're right. I don't want anybody to get it confused, even though what I'm about to say won't matter come fight night and come Sunday. If I picked wrong, they're going to give me shit. But this is a pick 'em fight.
Right.
But
that's,
I'm picking
how I see it.
Lamont
how I
Peterson.
See it. I don't think anybody should be a big favorite.
I'm picking Lamont Peterson. That's all. It's a pick 'em fight, but my pick is Peterson. I think he'll do it.
And, well, let me just say real quick what I. Here's what scares me for Peterson. Here's what scares me for him. Peterson likes to fight on the inside, and he's not the hardest guy to hit. And I do believe Matisse has legit power. I know he had a lot of trouble with Alexander and Judah. Whether you think he won or not, that's a different conversation. But you can't deny at worst he lost a fair amount of rounds and had some trouble. And Peterson's a little more quick in there. He likes fighting on the inside like that, but I don't know if that's the best strategy for him against Matisse because, like I said, I believe in that two-handed power, but I think Lamont's going to – he looked really good against Holt. I know he got hit a lot for people's liking, but I think he's going to rise to the occasion. He just seems like he's ready to grab some shine, this kid. He seems hungry in there.
Mike, I hope that you're right, and I hope that you and I both get to sing and dance come Sunday, but I got to let you go. I got another caller on the line, and like I said, man, I hope that we're both right.
Yeah, well, Matt, you know what? I hope I'm wrong because I love Matisse, but I can't – that doesn't change how I think. But actually, I'm going to be rooting for Matisse. I just don't see it happening, but we'll see. We'll see. Good show, Matt.
All right, brother. 776, you're live. 774? Who's this? Where are you calling from? Yeah, 774, I'm sorry.
This is E4 is King again.
Okay, what's up, E4 is King? Ruger took a shot at you, man.
I'm sorry, I didn't get that.
I said Ruger took a shot at you. He said you just called in to give your info for the glove. He said you didn't even talk boxing.
I wasn't that. I just didn't have much to say, so I made it a short call. But just wanted to give you my thoughts on the Matisse-Peterson fight. You know, going into the fight, I was thinking that Peterson was gonna go in there and just outbox him, which I feel that if he goes in there and he boxes, I think it's a pretty easy night for him. But my gut is telling me that he's gonna get brave and start slugging it out with him, and I think he's gonna get caught in the later rounds. I think he might have a lot more confidence in his power now, coming from that knockout win against Kim Holt. And I think that might ultimately lead to him getting knocked out.
Wait a minute. I don't know if I heard you right. Who's getting knocked out?
I think that Pearson's going to end up getting knocked out. I think he's gonna be winning the fight. And then at some point, he's going to start slugging it out with him, and he's going to get caught. Hello?
I think there's no question that they're going to slug it out.
Yeah, and I mean, I've read some interviews where Peterson's saying that he's going in there to go toe-to-toe with him, and I just don't think that's the way to beat him. I think that's the way you end up getting knocked out.
Yeah, but I mean, I like Peterson's chance in a slugfest. I mean, that dude can bang to the body with the best of them, but that's really about it. And to me, that's just me. I don't see this boxing skill that everybody else sees. I mean, I don't see it. I think he's a banger, and I think he has a hell of a shot against Matisse banging, and I think we see a real good fight.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a great fight. I know that Matisse hasn't fought the level of opposition that Peterson has fought, but, you know, I mean, you could say that his chin really hasn't been tested, but I've never really seen him shook up, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And again, he hasn't really fought anybody with a lot of power, you know, so, I mean, I think it's going to be a great fight. It is a pick 'em fight. I can really see both guys winning. I just think that Peterson is going to have a lot of confidence in his power, and I think it's going to lead to him.
I got a little hunch telling me Peterson has more power than Matisse. I don't know. Mm. It's just me. The body punches that he gave Conlan and Peterson, I mean, is something beautiful, man. He is hard as shit. But the boxing skill, I'm not seeing it.
You know, another thing. Another thing is that, you know, he got dropped by Bradley, and Bradley doesn't really have that much power, and, you know, I think Matisse is harder than Bradley. You know, so
do you think Matisse hits harder than Victor Ortiz?
He got hard, though.
I don't know. I don't know.
No, but Bradley has some wheels on him.
Well, I'm going to get to this other caller. Kimfo, go ahead and get your point across, brother. We got to end this show.
All right. I just want to know why. I mean, everybody counting Peterson out, man. You got to realize that. I don't think Matisse been in the ring with somebody as rough as Peterson, man. He's a rugged fighter when you get through. And I think he's going to get in there and rough his ass up. I just really think that. I'm going with Peterson, dog. 8-round stoppage.
Well, I hope that you're right.
That's
and I hope
going
you get
well,
the singing dance right along
it.
With
yeah,
me, you and
drunk,
Mike, man.
He gets, that boy got hard, man. He gets up. And Ortiz hit way harder than Matisse. And he gets up. He just gets up, man. I don't say Matisse ain't never been touched. I want to see somebody touch his ass. Then what happens? Yeah, then you're going to see.
Absolutely. Well, good luck, man. You calling real late into the show. We got to go. Thanks for calling, though. Remember, Thursday we're going to have a glove giveaway, so be sure to tune in early, brother.
All right, Kevin Fo. Holla at your boy.
For sure. All right, fellas. Well, as always, I want to thank you all for joining in. Everyone hating on me in the chat, thank you. You're only going to make this victory a lot better. But help us out. Oh, Gustavo Sanchez. Gustavo, what's up, brother?
What's happening, man?
Where you calling from, Gustavo?
I'm calling from Merced, California in the Central Valley, 209.
All right, brother. What's going on? What's on your mind, man? Make it quick because we're about to end the show.
All right. The Matisse Peterson fight. I really don't have a whole lot of hope for Peterson winning that one. I think Matisse can take all them punches that Peterson throws at him. I mean, dude lost to a sloppy-ass Bradley. You know what I mean?
Sloppy-ass Bradley. Why don't you tell me who's beat Bradley?
Well, Pacquiao beat Bradley, and it was a horrible fight.
All right, let's just say Pacquiao beat Bradley. That's a good point. Didn't Bradley negate everything that Devin Alexander did?
With his head, man. With his head, how many times did he headbutt him?
Gustavo, you cannot discredit Lamont Peterson for losing to Bradley when Bradley's been in the ring and beat Devin Alexander, Casamayor, Junior Witter, what's this guy's name at 147? Luis Carlos Abregu. I mean, the dude just knows how to win. He beat Lamont Peterson. I mean, I don't even know how you use that as an argument, dude. Bradley is tested and proven.
You know what? He can take punches. That's to me, that's what I can see. That's what I see.
Oh, and don't forget, Bradley beat everybody's new favorite fighter in Povotnikov.
You know what, man? I call that. That was a close fight. That one could have gone either way.
But who won?
True.
I got my scorecard. It wasn't a close fight like that.
How many rounds have Bradley
up? Plug my phone up before my scorecard. I'm gonna plug up my phone. Don't worry about it, cause that's bogus. That's ludicrous what you just said. Hold on. Here we go. Bradley fight. Bradley, where you at? Mares, Cruz Munoz, Rosado Love.
Well, let me ask you this.
Here we go. Bradley won the 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, and 11th. Lost the 12th. Also won the 3rd, the 4th, the 5th. And your boy Ruslan, he got the 10-8 on the 6th round, 10-8 on the 1st and the 2nd round. And that's only, matter of fact, the 6th round is only if you wanted to give him a 10-8. So that was a 10-9. So the score was actually 113, 114, right?
Yeah, well, you're not scoring that knockdown that he got that was ruled a slip.
Well, of course not. If it's ruled
bullshit,
a slip.
Man.
Dude, I can't score. I mean, look, I got two scorecards for this fight. This scorecard, giving Ruslan every round that he looked good, a 10-8 round, gives him a draw. He never won the fight. The actual scorecard, I'm going to read it to you. Custom scorecards. Where are we at? Bradley Provodnikov. I had Bradley winning 115-112 on the actual scorecard. Because in the round 10 and round 6, you could only give Provodnikov 10-9. So it doesn't matter, dude.
That's a cold game, man.
Yeah, well, just make sure, Gustavo, I will be calling you Sunday if Peterson wins.
Yeah, I'm going to be waiting for it, man. That's all I'm saying. I got finals on Monday.
Well, I
got
to let you go, brother.
My homework.
I got to let you go because I got to end the show. But definitely tune in, brother. We're going to be doing more glove giveaways, and it's real easy to win.
That's what's up. Thanks, Ness.
All right. Well, guys, once again, I just want you to all pat yourselves on the back. You've been doing a great job helping us share the show. Rating the show on iTunes is so detrimental. iTunes is the biggest podcast directory in the world. And the more reviews you give us, the higher ranked we are in terms of search. So if a person just puts B-O-X or B-O, Boxing Voice will come up, more people will tune in, more people will call in, and you'll have more people to call the mini bums and Euro bums and Puerto Rican bums. And, you know, so as always,
remember to rate us 5 stars on iTunes.
And definitely our showtimes.
Join us every Thursday and Sunday live at 7 p.m. Eastern Time.
All our information could be found at
checkoutTheBoxingVoice.com for some of the best articles on the hottest news in today's boxing.
And since you guys are all fans of Lucas Matisse, I will be having all that fight coverage this week. I'm going to do my very best to do as good as I did for the Judah Garcia. So you must
subscribe to YouTube.com/TheBoxingVoice for the latest and greatest interviews with your favorite fighters.
Because that's where all those video interviews will be. I want to thank everybody for tuning in. We'll catch you Thursday night. And, you know, have a good weekend or whatever. The weekend's over, so I guess happy Mondays.